At the end of the day, bro, I was making, the most I ever made was $10 million a year. I'd be damned if I gave a fuck what somebody had to say with me about me. I was still going to bed with the AC on 60 and the fan blowing in my face.
With the new school year underway, we're going to spend some time now looking at significant challenges that students, families, and districts around the country are facing. Stephanie Tsai starts us off with a look at how this heat wave in much of the country is creating problems for schools.
Jeff, these near triple-digit temperatures have led to school districts either closing or dismissing students early in at least 9 states this week. It's also raised questions about old school buildings, the lack of air conditioning, and ventilation concerns that arose during the peak of COVID. Joseph Allen has long focused on this as the director of the Healthy Buildings Program at Harvard's Chan School of Public Health. Joe, it's a pleasure to have you on the NewsHour. I want to start by asking, what should schools be doing now and going forward to better prepare for extreme heat?
Yeah, so thanks for having me on. Unfortunately, this was entirely predictable. I mean, the climate crisis is hitting us on two fronts. We're having longer and more intense heat waves that start earlier in the season and showing up later in the season like we have now. This is a particular problem for schools in traditionally cool weather climates that were designed to retain heat. So what to do right now? At a minimum, we have to provide cooling for students, right? That is the simple answer. It's an obvious fix. The money's actually there. And it doesn't have to be more complicated than that. There are other things we need to do, but in the immediate term, we can't have kids missing school because of heat. And this problem is only going to get worse.
And going forward, do they need to retrofit these buildings to better handle the realities of climate change?
Yeah, they do. And it's fortunately, it's not that hard. It's not that expensive. The money is there. And also, I think we have to stop thinking of these as separate crises. And the crises I'm talking about are things like extreme heat events or exposure to wildfire smoke and air pollution or COVID-19 and influenza. All of these crises run through our buildings. And they're crises because we're not operating and designing our school buildings correctly. If we improve ventilation and filtration, we address COVID-19, influenza, RSV, outdoor air pollution, wildfire smoke, and yes, extreme heat. So we're having these conversations all through the summer about different crises. They're all related. They all run through our buildings, and so do the solutions.
Besides immediately installing HVAC systems in Northeast schools and ventilation systems, won't it take quite a long time to address the fact that so many schools in this country are just in old buildings?
Well, it seems like this is an overwhelming problem, but fortunately the solutions are really straightforward. And there are things you can do in any kind of building to make it more comfortable, more safe, improve ventilation. Things like using heat pumps, which are also good for the climate crisis in the sense that they can provide cooling through the use of electricity and heating through the use of electricity. I know school districts that did exactly that, installed heat pumps for each classroom. There are even basic things like air conditioning for the window units, while these larger replacements that need to take place are happening. I reject the notion that we can't act because it's too hard or too long. This money has been sitting around for years. So we had the COVID crisis and it wasn't spent. So this idea that maybe it was just too hard or too long, well, it's been years. Why hasn't that been spent? And if we go even back longer, it's been decades since we've improved our school infrastructure. I tell you, this moment makes me really nervous because we're never going to get these kind of funds again for our schools. We haven't in the history of our schools. And it's a chance to fix what has been decades of neglect of our school buildings. And we have to take a step back and recognize that the way our buildings are designed and running are having a massive impact on our kids' learning. And that's across respiratory infections all the way through extreme temperature and pollution. And it's not hard to do. And there's still, you know, it's the time to act was yesterday. And if you couldn't do it yesterday, you have to do it right now.
You keep saying that the money is there. Are you referring to the American Rescue Plan money, the billions of dollars that were put towards schools at the peak of the pandemic? Should they have prioritized air conditioning and ventilation and air quality higher?
Yes, absolutely. That's the money I'm referring to. It's a once-in-a-generation opportunity to fix our crumbling school infrastructure. Billions and billions of dollars were allocated towards schools to improve ventilation and filtration to address COVID-19. The shocking thing, and everyone should be really upset about this, is that in many states, the majority of that money has not been spent. So think about that. We had a COVID crisis, tens of millions of kids out of school, an airborne virus. We know ventilation and filtration help. and that money wasn't spent. Now, that money is still available, but not for much longer. If we make these improvements to the school building for COVID, it helps against those other infectious diseases and threats like this. It's totally unacceptable that we're closing schools due to extreme heat when we know what the solution is, the money's there. Absolute basics in this country, we have to provide safe, healthy, and comfortable learning environments for our students and our teachers. I find this totally unacceptable.
Yeah, and this leads me to the questions about achievement and the heat and these other issues affects on student behavior. And I read a statistic that researchers at Harvard have found heat effects account for 13% of the racial achievement gap. So are we also seeing uneven impacts along racial lines?
Well, yeah, we have the objective scientific data that shows it. And I don't think this would surprise anybody. But when you look at things like air quality or ventilation standards or rates of outdoor air brought into schools, we see that in schools that are predominantly Black or Hispanic student populations have even lower ventilation rates. We see the same thing in schools where the majority of students are on free or reduced lunch, so lower income students. We see these schools have lower ventilation rates. Totally unacceptable that we have anyone in any school anywhere as an uncomfortable, unsafe, unhealthy environment. And then we also see disparities across race, ethnicity, and income.
Joe Allen at the Harvard School of Public Health, thank you so much for your insights.
Yeah, thanks for having me on.
Could have told Indians that. Same thing. Some of them did start off with, but then they got attitude. Say, no, we're going to take it all. You know, we ain't going to leave you nothing. Right? Indians said, well, you know, I thought we were going to share. I mean, you know, that's what we sat down at Thanksgiving, I mean, you know, and say we all work together and all like that. Well, I don't think that's a good idea. What I need to do is going back to giving you a good whipping, chief. That's all it was. Chief said, there's plenty of land here for everybody. We got more land than we can take care of and whatnot. So, I mean, we welcome you and all like that. Well, no, I'm going to take it all. Give you a bottle of whiskey. That's what you're going to get out of the deal. Right.
For more than a century, hundreds of thousands of Native American children were forced to attend boarding schools, many of them supported by the federal government in the name of assimilation and tied to land possession. Those schools stripped children of their language and culture, and they suffered abuse, neglect, beatings, and forced child labor. Deaths are estimated to be in the thousands. Stephanie Tsai focuses on new findings about the role of churches and religious groups.
A federal probe into Native American boarding schools has been underway since 2022, but recently a nonprofit group identified even more schools. The National Native American Boarding School Healing Coalition has found 523 boarding schools operated across 38 states, including 115 previously unidentified schools that were largely run by Christian churches. The largest concentration of schools were in Oklahoma and the Four Corners region of the Southwest, home of the Navajo Nation. The nonprofit's Deputy Chief Executive Officer is Samuel Torres, and he joins me now to discuss this new research. Samuel, thank you so much for joining the NewsHour. So I understand your latest research found dozens more boarding schools that were operated in Hawaii as well as Oklahoma. Talk about that and the other significant findings you've uncovered.
Well, we're grateful for the opportunity to continue to work on this type of project. And building on top of that 408 federally funded or supported schools identified in collaboration between the Department of the Interior and ourselves at the Healing Coalition, we felt it was really important to build off of that and really make sure that we're including the scope of those 115 institutions where evidence has not been shown to connect the federal government to those boarding schools. It's really important for those institutions that we've identified in Oklahoma, in Alaska, and Hawaii, among many other states where there are an increased number of those institutions, where really we're starting to scratch the surface on how to identify the role of those Christian denominations, of the federal government, of the administrators and the operators of those schools.
The Christian denominations involved, which include the Roman Catholic Church, have begun their own investigations into the boarding schools they ran. What do you expect to come of that? And do we have a full picture of any abuse that occurred at the schools?
Well, I think it's important to state initially that while there's much more known about what happened at those federal Indian boarding schools than the privately controlled ones, I think this is where those archival records are really profoundly important to be accessed, to be able to understand what the depth of those details looks like. What we do know, though, is that the treatment and methods for operating Indian boarding schools largely utilized a lot of the same strategies toward a central goal of assimilating Native children by what we've heard so often in our own work, individuals being deprived of the influences and connections of their families, their communities, of their tribal nations, often being punished for speaking their own language, practicing their traditions, and at times even experiencing severe punishment, sexual abuse, spiritual abuse, and even death. So we really just are continuing to still asking the same kinds of questions on what has happened at these institutions. We are told and hear the stories of our relatives, our friends, those that we're connected with at the Healing Coalition about how they were treated in these institutions, whether they be in federally operated institutions or in privately controlled ones. And quite honestly, the time is now for us to be able to look into what that treatment was like from those records source. Because we have those stories, and it's not that these stories haven't been told, it's that they haven't been listened to. And if they can be coupled by the access of these documents, we can start looking at, in a more comprehensive effort, a fuller scope of what happened at these Indian boarding schools, whether they be federally controlled or privately run.
It was back in 1969, from what I understand, that the U.S. Senate issued several hundred pages of a report on the Native American boarding school system. And that did lead to some reforms. I just wonder, Samuel, what you would like to see happen now as more and more of this comes to light.
Really, what we've never seen to this point is a comprehensive investigation that actually, in a culturally responsive way, bring in boarding school survivors and ask them to share their testimonies. The Healing Coalition is calling for a Truth and Healing Commission on U.S. Indian Boarding School Policies Act, currently passed out of a committee and waiting for a Senate floor vote, Senate Bill 1723. We are hoping for the bill to be introduced and passed out of committee in the House of Representatives as well. We're looking for a multi-year commission process that does more than just brings these questions to the table. It asks communities, Native leaders, tribal leaders to come and to help support this process, and ultimately will publish a series of calls to action that will provide a blueprint for how do we restore that which was disrupted.
Samuel Torres with the National Native American Boarding School Healing Coalition, thank you so much.
Yes, thank you for your time.
I was the first, one of the first. My first day was state trooper coming, putting me in the back seat of the car, and meeting the other black kids, with six of us. And seeing all of those parents and also KKK members having signs and throwing cans at us, spitting at us. We lived in the threat of death every day, every day. So I was just lost in this vacuum between integration and segregation and racism. That was my childhood. I was angry for years. Angry. Very angry.
Welcome back. In tonight's History Untold, the integration of one of the wealthiest school districts in San Antonio, as it still is now. The Alamo Heights Independent School District was predominantly white when the U.S. Supreme Court ruled separate but equal was unconstitutional.
Jesse DeGliotto spoke to some of the district's first African-American students who say they weren't exactly welcomed with open arms.
A grandmother and a retired teacher and nurse, Judy Green has never forgotten her first day in ninth grade at Alamo Heights High School.
That first day was rough.
That's putting it mildly. Judy Green says the racist slurs she had to endure was not just kids being kids.
Didn't matter. they had been taught that black is dirty.
The U.S. Supreme Court had struck down Separate But Equal as unconstitutional in 1954. After that, Green says eight in all integrated the Alamo Heights School District, and she still remembers.
Being harassed, followed down the hall, called colored, you colored, we don't want you colored here.
Yet decades later.
It's just traumatic. Like it's really, like, I don't know what they're afraid of you.
By the time Terrell Robinson graduated in 2002 as a young, openly gay African-American.
I got so much academically, but the price I had to pay was like, I'll never get that back. I'll never get that peace of mind.
Not surprising, say Everett Fly and Dr. Joseph Lambert, recognized as distinguished alumni of Alamo Heights High School. Fly, a respected landscape architect, awarded a National Humanities Medal by President Obama, knows firsthand what it was like.
It was made clear that people did not want to be seen with me. They didn't want to be in a picture with me because of my race.
When Lambert, a future research professor of chemistry, was a student at Alamo Heights.
I never thought about how hard it must have been for those kids to enter an all-white school.
That is until he saw John Henry Smith before he made the junior varsity football team. He was on a stairwell looking lonely and lost.
But that one moment has carried with me all my life.
Fly says the district's reputation then haunts it even now.
And it's still strong enough to discourage people from wanting to live in the Alamo Heights School District, especially people of color.
In a statement, a spokesperson for the Alamo Heights Independent School District says, quote, it is horrible that any Alamo Heights ISD students at any time in our history would have had experiences like these. We empathize with their pain, and we deeply regret that they or any students had to experience such treatment. Racist treatment and harassment of any person at any time, anywhere, is never condoned. While we can't speak for the students of the past, we can assure you that today our campuses work intentionally to prevent those types of behaviors. Racist treatment and harassment is prohibited and should be reported to school administrators and will be responded to accordingly. End quote. Jesse Degollado, KSAT 12 News.
And the district's full response to this story can be read right now on our website at KSAT.com.
And some began to say the threats, or talk about the threats that were out. What would happen to me from some of our sick white brothers?
Before killing three people at a Dollar General store in Jacksonville, Florida last week, the gunman made a stop. Edward Waters University and HBCU. Its president says students spotted him putting on gloves and an armored vest in a library parking lot. They went and got a security officer.
Lieutenant Antonio Bailey, he then began to approach the individual who by that time was now seated in his vehicle, at which time, upon recognizing the presence of Lieutenant Bailey, the individual immediately fled the university parking lot, jumping the curb and nearly hitting a nearby brick column in the parking lot.
It's not clear if the HBCU was a target for the shooter, who was a white supremacist, but are historically black colleges and universities on guard? Lance Hatcher is chief of police at Morgan State University and HBCU in Baltimore. He joins us now. Welcome to the program.
Thank you, Aisha. Glad to be here.
How often did you think about schools like yours, HBCUs, being targets of racist violence before last week's shooting in Jacksonville?
Well, unfortunately, we think about it quite often, you know, if not daily, weekly. So we subscribe to the theory that not if, but when, and that's how we drive ourselves daily to ensure that we can at least try to prevent these things, and if not, mitigate them.
Has Morgan State had many credible threats of racially motivated violence?
We have not, fortunately. The most recent that we've had was the bombing threats back, I believe, about a year ago that Morgan and many other HBCUs received.
How did that affect the campus? How did that affect the way you approach your job?
It did not negatively affect us. We routinely subscribe to the fact that we don't get prepared, we stay prepared. So when they first started to occur, Texas Southern was one of the first ones that received it. We're all part of a consortium of chiefs of police and directors of security for HBCUs. So we've communicated at that time what was going on and the challenges that we were encountering with the bomb threats. And through our conversations, we were prepared when we received ours in the beginning of February.
What steps has Morgan State taken to adapt to the rising threat of violent extremism and mass shootings in the U.S.?
Well, we've invested very significantly in upgrading cameras. We have approximately 1,000 cameras on campus, lighting on campus, additional police officers, security officers that belong and work for the institution itself. And then we have a contractual security company that supplies us upwards of 25 security officers per shift. And we have them strategically placed on campus and in our residential on-campus housing as well as our off-campus housing.
You know, it's no secret that HBCUs are generally underfunded. How does that complicate safety planning?
Historically, for HBCUs, it does make it challenging. We may not have the financial resources that white institutions may have. However, as far as Morgan, I can only speak for Morgan. Dr. Wilson, the president of Morgan State University, lobbied and petitioned the lawmakers in Annapolis and has secured additional funding for police and safety on campus. Also, as the police department, we have sought out grants that allow us to purchase body-worn cameras, vehicles, as well as bullet-resistant vests. So it is a challenge, but it's not insurmountable.
That's Lance Hatcher, Morgan State University's chief of police. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me, and I'm glad to be here.
So how's the college responding to this incident?
We're having a race forum.
And what's that?
A forum on race, so we can discuss the incident and the surrounding issues of race.
So the usual lip service.
No comment.
Channel 2 Action News exclusive. Some students speaking out after a racial slur was spray painted inside an off-campus apartment building. They're also concerned about trash. It's in the halls. Channel 2 Cobb County Bureau Chief Michelle Newell live near Kennesaw State University. Michelle, students told you all that's just part of the problem.
Yeah, and Linda, they showed me pictures and videos of trash in the hallways, dog feces, and they say the fire alarm inside this building just keeps going off. Within the last 30 minutes, a company representative told me they sent a technician out here today to repair the problem.
I was ready to break my lease and leave.
That's how Elise Powell felt after she saw a racial slur spray painted on a wall inside of the building she lives in.
I feel concerned just because there are a lot of people of color in our building as well. To kind of just let it slide and paint over it.
It's just one of several problems some students say they've complained about to management at the Indy, an apartment complex near Kennesaw State University, where a lot of students live.
The trash is disgusting. Oh my gosh, I smell it a mile away.
You can see trash up and down this hallway. Students say they are even losing sleep because of this.
It's daily. Every morning, I think between like 11 p.m. to 5 a.m. There's just people pulling alarms.
This statement from a company representative says lightning damage from a recent storm is triggering the fire alarms. The statement goes on to say, quote, in addition to the fire alarms, many images from previous seasons were included. These incidents are taken seriously. Each of these shown are from prior years and have been addressed. Students I spoke with say the problems are recent.
They're telling us to look out for the people doing the slurs. They're telling us to put up the trash. They're telling us to look out for the people doing the fire alarm.
In a statement, management also told me the videos we were shown are from the previous school year and the problems were addressed. Students dispute that too. Now, in addition to the lightning damage being the cause of this fire alarm issue, management also told me they believe someone is doing this on purpose. Live from Cobb County, Michelle Newell, Channel 2 Action News.
And another one. It's so gorgeous. It's another beautiful day in North Carolina, y'all. Y'all should really be here to see it.
The U.S. is seeing a surge in efforts to ban or restrict books in schools. One school board in North Carolina recently voted to temporarily remove a book about the history of racism in the U.S. from high school classrooms. And as WHQR's Rachel Keith reports, a lone parent was behind the move.
Katie Gates was upset that her daughter's teacher assigned the book Stamped, Racism, Anti-Racism, and You in an AP language and composition class. She told the school board at a packed public hearing the book is anti-American.
They brainwash the reader that all the white people are racist and are to blame for everything wrong in America. How do you think these claims make everyday average white students required to read this book feel?
Gates was demanding the removal of the book from the curriculum. Stamped is a frequent target for book bans across the country. Assistant Superintendent Don Brinson tried to defend the use of the book to no avail.
Ms. Gates' claim that Stamped is anti-American is not a fact. It is her opinion.
Gates had tried unsuccessfully to convince two curriculum committees to remove the book. Her last resort, the school board. Last November, Republicans swept the elections, taking control from Democrats. Those GOP candidates campaigned on parental rights and stopping what they call liberal indoctrination in schools. Enough Republicans agreed with Gates, who welcomed the decision to pull the book.
I feel like there's accountability. To me, that's huge.
Katie Gates is an active member of the local GOP, but Republicans aren't always in lockstep in removing controversial texts from the nation's classrooms. A national NPR Ipsos poll conducted in May of this year shows that half of Republicans oppose book bans. So does Stephanie Craybill. She was the only Republican on the school board to oppose the book's removal.
I've been a Republican since I was 18 years old. I believe that the Republican Party in some areas of our country has morphed away from just conservative, moderate values.
New Hanover County Schools serves suburban Wilmington, and its student population is 60% white. What worries North Carolina NAACP President Deborah Dix Maxwell is that the school board is ignoring important black voices.
So it's going to make teachers who decide the curriculum to pick the safe route instead of the route that will envelop more critical thinking. You just diminished it by your vote.
As for the teacher, Kelly Kidwell, who had required the book, she now has to choose another text that the board said needs to be, quote, balanced. She says she's disappointed that one parent can have so much control over her classroom.
I feel a little powerless because I feel like this is just the first of many dominoes to fall before the tides shift again. But I will continue to teach to the best of my ability and do right by the students I have in my classroom right now.
The North Carolina NAACP is now considering a lawsuit similar to the one in South Carolina, where parents are challenging a school board that also voted to remove Stamped from classrooms. For NPR News, I'm Rachel Keith in Wilmington, North Carolina.
You see, but they're very unhappy about their appearance. I think there's an article in the handout about a woman who was, white woman who was in Hawaii. And she said that being around the Hawaiian people and the Asian people, and she said she was tall and white and pale, she said she felt like a freak. And so then she started getting involved in genetic science.
Now, what constitutes life? Well, scientists have managed to create a near-exact replica of a 14-day-old human embryo without using sperm, an egg, or a womb. The so-called model embryo contained all the cell types needed to develop and grow. The scientists from the Weizmann Institute in Israel say their research aims to shed light on the mysterious but crucial early days after conception. It could lead to new breakthroughs in preventing early miscarriage and in the development of new technologies for growing organs for transplant. Lead scientist Professor Jacob Hanna explains how it could help.
We want to make cells for transplantation, and we want to be the cells identical to the patient who receives them. One of the dreams of this technology is, say, there is a person who is really about to die because he or she cannot find a bone marrow transplant, to take a skin biopsy, make stem cells, and then differentiate them into this embryo-like model, let's say for 40 days, and then we can transplant it back to the patient without looking for donor, without having the risk of rejection, because these cells cannot be rejected.
Professor Jacob Hanna of the Weizmann Institute. So how exciting a moment is this for science? Our health and science correspondent is James Gallagher.
I think really quite exciting, Oliver. We've had a lot of research, a lot of progress in terms of trying to do this in the laboratory. But this is the first time that team of scientists have actually been able to get to the point where they can say this version of an embryo we have grown in a laboratory looks pretty much the same as one that would develop naturally. And reaching that level has caused quite a lot of excitement amongst other scientists and researchers today.
So pretty much the same. Are there differences, or could this grow into a human?
No. And there are many reasons for that. One of them is simply that it's illegal and you would never be allowed to do this pretty much anywhere in the world that has laws around this area would not let you do this. There are also some scientific reasons why we don't think it would work. So the way that it is designed, you actually end up missing some of the earliest days of embryo development. And by the time that it starts to look like something embryo-like, it's probably missed the opportunity that you could put it into a womb and it would actually embed itself into the walls of the womb and actually form a pregnancy. So scientifically, there are big questions there as well.
But they have created this amazing replica. How did they do it?
So traditionally, one sperm meets one egg, they fuse and an embryo emerges. And there are no sperm or eggs or wombs involved in any of this. So they use something called stem cells. And those are the ones that have the capacity to become any type of tissue in the human body. And they coax those using like subtle chemicals into the four types of cell you would find in a week-old embryo. And then you mix around about 120 of those together in the laboratory, and it just looks like a jumbled up mess to start off with. But as they grow over a period of 8 days, they start to organize themselves with no input from scientists. They're doing it all themselves into something that actually resembles a 14-day-old human embryo. And that's the first time that's ever happened.
Now, in many countries, 14 days is the legal cutoff for embryonic research. Could they get round that and grow these models into older replicas?
You're onto a really interesting good point here, because the legal limit for human embryo research is 14 days in many countries. These aren't human embryos. As a legal entity, they're known as an embryo model, so they don't have to abide by those same rules. So technically, if scientists decided they wanted to, they could attempt to go beyond the 14-day rule and see later stages of embryo development. Some people would welcome that as a way of studying that period of our development. Others would be horrified. And I think we're very much in a point where the science has leapt well ahead of where regulation is anywhere in the world for actually deciding what is right, what's ethically acceptable, what's legally acceptable. Because the closer scientists come to replicating an embryo in a dish, it will lead many people to ask, well, shouldn't they be treated in the same way as an embryo? It is a very live ethical debate right now.
Our health and science correspondent, James Gallagher.
I ever tell you about the first time I leave the state of Georgia?
When was that?
A few minutes back.
What?
Yes. Now, my daughter, she's married to a Pullman porter, you know. She's always on the go. New York, Detroit, St. Louis. I said, well, now, that's all well and good, Tommy Lee. I just don't feel the need for it. So here it's here. First time. And I might tell you, Miss Daisy, Alabama ain't looking like much so far.
It's often a straightforward process in this country. You hold an election for office, a clear winner is declared, and that person assumes the position once the votes are counted and certified. But New Bern, Alabama is a bit different. They haven't held elections for years, with a position often handed down from father to son for multiple generations, until one man went against the norm. And he says it's led to him being blocked from his mayoral duties for years. Now the battle over who's really in charge is at the center of a federal lawsuit as tensions run high. Our Steve Osunsami has the tale of two mayors.
New Bern, Alabama is one of those small places in America where you'll find nearly a dozen churches to worship the Lord, but not a single grocery store. It's barely a mile long with about 200 people, an old cotton town where the history of slavery still lives deep in the soil. Even the cemeteries are still racially segregated. This is where white people are buried. And over here is the dirt road that takes you to a hill where the descendants of former slaves still bury their dead today.
I'm not trying to divide the town, just want to make the town better.
For the first time ever, a child of those black ancestors has become the city's mayor, hoping he can bring people together. But in a lawsuit he's filed in federal court, he says that some of his white neighbors have kept him from the job and locked him out of office. And he's seen here arguing with one of them outside the building, a city clerk who he and his black voters tried to persuade to their side but failed.
What you're doing is unjust.
No, it's not.
It is. It's absolutely unjust. It's unjust by this gentleman and it's unjust by the people that are saying.
Do you feel cheated?
Oh, yeah.
Do you feel discriminated against?
Yes.
What is it that you want to see happen?
I want to take my rightful seat and I want to hold each and every one of them accountable for what they did.
56-year-old Patrick Braxton was born and raised here and became the city's first black mayor in 2020 when he quietly filed the paperwork at this county courthouse to run for the position. Up until that year, no one had ever officially put in for the job.
How many years has this place gone without an election?
I think they said about 60-something.
So then how was the mayor decided here?
Just hand it down.
And let me guess, what was the race of this mayor in this town? What's it always been?
White.
Yeah, every single time.
Yes.
The mayor at the time was this man, Haywood Stokes III. His father, Haywood Stokes Jr., who died 10 years ago, was the mayor before. And in a response to the federal lawsuit, he and his lawyers admit that the town of New Bern has not held an election for years prior to decide who leads their city. But they deny that there's any racism or a conspiracy here to keep black people out of office. He and Patrick Braxton are both volunteers at the fire station on Main Street. They've known each other for more than a decade. So it was a shock to everyone when the legal deadline had passed to run for the job, and this time a black man, Patrick Braxton, had gone through the trouble of filing the proper paperwork and was the one and only candidate. Months later, he was seen here, being sworn into office by a state judge. And like previous mayors before him, he appointed his own city council, who put their hands on the Bible that same warm evening.
You know, he was very excited. We had one meeting.
You did have a meeting in City Hall?
One, yes.
Oh.
We got a chance to come in, you know, and
try to get organized.
That was it.
They say it felt good in a town where 85% of the residents are black to finally have a city council that looked more like the people they serve.
So you met the former mayor, Woody, after you were sworn in?
Yes.
And there didn't appear to be any problems?
No problem.
And said, here are the keys?
Yeah.
And that's it?
That's it, and walked off.
So now you have a meeting at City Hall. When did the doors get locked?
Well,
I guess
we don't
the next day, notice. We don't know exactly when. I guess they knew we was there.
Can you imagine? It's a city hall. It's the town hall, and it's locked forever. It's been locked for 2 years now. Well, I feel that it's all about race. And I don't mind saying that. That's what it's about, because I've lived here all my life.
According to their lawsuit, they're also locked out of the city's accounts at this bank on the other side of the county. Meanwhile, the black city council members say that the old city council continues to collect taxes, pay the lawn crews, and somehow conduct regular business.
Do you even know who's holding the meetings?
No.
No, and they must be holding it in a private home.
You may hang up or press 1 for more options.
We tried more than once to get the former mayor's side of the story, knocking on his door when it appeared he was home. He didn't answer. In court filings, Woody III explains his position. accusing Mayor Braxton of living outside the city limits, which would disqualify Braxton from being the mayor. And it is true that Mayor Braxton has more than one home, one that he uses as his city residence that he rents, and this one where he lives with his family outside the city. Here's where it gets more complicated. Mr. Woody Stokes is arguing that he gets to hold on to the job because of a special election he claims was held in October to vote on the new city council, weeks before the black city council was sworn in, where only the old city council members qualified to run and because of that kept their jobs. He says his old city council put him back in charge. But in his lawsuit, Mayor Braxton says that his side didn't even know that a special election was happening and says that if it did, it was no good, saying that it took place in secret and that no notice of a special election was ever published.
Y'all just need to go on and leave us alone.
But there's not a story here.
We went to the Mercantile Store, a small diner across the street from the town hall, a place that black residents say is ground zero for Mayor Braxton's opposition. We were told to leave the room.
You just need to go on and leave us alone. It's going to be a black and white thing, and y'all know that.
If you're living and you're working here, someone can make your life living hell. It can really affect you, your family. You will be quiet.
On our walk with the mayor, the few white residents we met who support him were only comfortable telling us so off camera.
You see what I've been trying to tell you?
Yeah. Yeah. That people are afraid.
Yeah.
Of what?
I don't know where they live. They friends? Who gonna stop speaking to them?
One small exception was the kind woman working at the town's new library who didn't really want to take a side.
I think it's very unfortunate for the town of New Bern to have to go through this conflict. And I'm hoping that people will listen to each other and be graceful with each other and come together as the New Bern community.
Laquina Lewis has become sort of a political activist who works with the mayor.
Who's everyone afraid of around here?
You tell me. Power, the power structure.
These are some of the frightening letters filled with racial slurs that she says she's gotten in the mail.
This is why I just can't say it's not race. I received a lot of hate mail that referenced lynchings and name calling, referenced my children. So this is personal for me, and this is serious. This isn't a game. And obviously, people want it to go away.
One of the white residents who we saw in the restaurant, he said, you know, you guys are just going to make it about race.
Mm.
What do you say to that?
Look at the deck of cards. It's not necessarily about race, but we have to admit and be honest that race does play a small factor in this.
I feel so guilty. Really, I do, because we have allowed this to happen to us for years and years. We allowed it to happen. I've never known a black man, even if it was a white man, being elected mayor here in New Bern. I've never known that. And we should have say something, done something, see could we get some help from somewhere, but we didn't.
Why?
And that's what I asked myself, why?
The mayor, who according to a state court is still this man, wants the state or federal court to come to town and make things right. But if they don't, he says he's not going away and that there will be a real election when his term is up. He has big hopes to finally bring in a grocery store. It's high time, he says, for black folks in small towns like his to start claiming a little more agency over their own lives.
It has to disappoint you that it's along racial lines.
Yes. Because I had one little lady told me the town wasn't ready for a black male.
Someone told you that?
Yes.
Was it a white lady?
Yes.
Told you that? The town wasn't ready for a black man.
Yes.
What did you say to her?
They better get ready. Because I'm him.
The
This morning, there are growing concerns and calls for change after another person died at the Fulton County Jail. Since September of last year, the Fulton County Sheriff's Office says 17 people have died while in custody, five of those being since August 1st, a life lost each week. The most recent, 24-year-old Chandre Delmore. Later this morning, his family is having a news conference. Ariana Manise is outside the Fulton County Jail this morning with more. Ariana, this family and many others wanting answers.
That's right, Cheryl. And this 24-year-old's family, they're wondering, how did this young man die in custody? And Fulton County commissioners, they're wondering how to fix the problems plaguing the Rice Street Jail. It's happened again. Another inmate dying in custody at the Fulton County Jail. 24-year-old Chandre Delmore died on Sunday, 3 days after being found unresponsive in his cell. An attorney representing his family saying in the statement, the family is devastated by this loss. They're left wondering how a healthy 24-year-old dies of cardiac arrest. We are committed to doing whatever is necessary to help his family get the answers they deserve so they can begin to grieve. Delmar was arrested on April 1st for burglary and obstruction of law enforcement charges and held on a $2,500 bond. His death continues an alarming trend at the Rice Street Jail. Since August 1st, an inmate has died every week.
You can't sugarcoat it. We have a problem in our jail.
Chairman Rob Pitt says this is a problem the county needs to address.
The question now is, what do we do about it?
And their top priority is cutting down on overcrowding at the jail.
That's what the board is focusing in on now.
Pitt says the county is considering moving inmates out of the jail to different prisons, one in Georgia, the other in Mississippi.
Which theoretically should mean that the sheriff, who is responsible for the jail, he and his deputies should be able to manage better a reduced number of inmates.
Pitt says the county must also answer,
why is it overcrowded? It's overcrowded because the district attorney is not indicting, the solicitor is not doing his job to the extent that he should, and the judges, Lord knows, they are not doing their job.
Chairman Pitt says it's 100 to 1,000 inmates in custody who've been waiting months to even years to be indicted, while others have quickly been processed through the jail.
And you turn on TV, here comes some, you know, white collar suits come down and they go breeze in and out like it's nothing. Your loved one, local, just sitting there. People are getting pissed off. Period.
Pitts tells us that Fulton County Sheriff Pat Labatt, his plan is to go to those prisons that they're considering moving inmates to next week with the goal of moving the inmates within the next 3 weeks. He said they're still researching whether the law allows them to move these inmates so far away from their attorneys. Meanwhile, this all comes as the DOJ, they're investigating what's happening here at the Rice Street Jail due to allegations of unsanitary conditions and inadequate medical care for the inmates. Back to you.
Because ugly white women used to say they got raped by niggas.
Hey, a nigger raped me.
Yeah, and the guys be going, hey, you sure? Yeah, they go round up some niggers, you know, like, oh, you were down last week, you know what to do, don't you? Well, come on down again, will you? We got to have a lineup. Well, it was a lot of fun unless you got picked. That was your ass.
A rape conviction from 1976 in Westchester County overturned. The 72-year-old was exonerated by DNA, which made history as the oldest exoneration by DNA in the United States. An incredible day. Eyewitness News reporter Marcus Solis joins us live from White Plains with this story. Marcus.
Mike, an emotional day as well, and it is all taking place on Leonard Mack's 72nd birthday. He calls it the best birthday gift he could have ever imagined. In some ways, he is reborn. His good name has been restored. The last time Leonard Mack walked into the Westchester County Courthouse, he was in handcuffs, about to be sentenced to prison for rape. Today was different.
After 48 years, I'm finally going to get closure to this and clear my name.
In 1975, the Vietnam veteran was charged with tying up two high school students at gunpoint, brutally raping one of them. He was identified after questionable police tactics. His clothing was changed to match the description of the suspect, and his picture was the only black man included in a photo array.
People just don't know how it feels to be accused of something you didn't do.
Max served his entire 7.5-year sentence but kept fighting to clear his name. The Innocence Project took up the case, and the Westchester DA's office's conviction review unit had DNA evidence tested, something that didn't exist at the time of his trial. Not only did it clear Mac, it linked another man to the crime, who confessed. The DA pointing out the wrongful conviction not only robbed Mac of his freedom, it failed the public.
Because while the wrongfully convicted sit behind bars, the actual perpetrators are free to commit additional crimes. And we believe that is what happened in this case.
In court, Mac tearfully described living nearly 50 years with the stigma and shame of being labeled a rapist, a miscarriage of justice that drew apologies from the district attorney and an emotional exchange with the judge who finalized his exoneration.
And now I can truly say, now I can truly say that I'm free.
Well, also acknowledged today is that there are two victims reliving the trauma of sorts of what happened, two women who were notified about what happened. The person who is now linked to this case and has confessed to this case cannot be prosecuted because of the statute of limitations. Even worse, he was convicted of another rape that occurred 2 weeks after the original incident. In 2004, he pleaded guilty to another sex offense, and he is currently being prosecuted. He is in custody for failing to register with authorities as a registered sex offender.
What would happen to me from some of our sick white brothers?
Mike, you've learned the suspect never should have been on the streets in the first place.
Yeah, that's right, Laurel. Late this afternoon, we learned that Adrian Cummins was arrested in mid-August for missing an earlier court appearance. And there was a court order that he be held in jail until late September. But for reasons that are not yet clear to us, deputies in the jail turned Cummins away. That put him back on the street and at the center of this most recent case. One that we want to warn you is quite disturbing. That's Adrian Cummins in a Multnomah County courtroom Tuesday afternoon. Cummins pleaded not guilty to nearly a dozen charges, including attempted murder, assault, and bias crime. It's alleged that on Saturday evening, two 17-year-old boys, both black, were riding the max when Cummins yelled FN-word at them and attacked them.
Nigga!
Court documents suggest Cummins stabbed one teen in the arm and the other in the chest. That boy's heart was nicked by the knife. He had bleeding around the lungs, and his chest had to be opened for surgery. At last check, he was intubated in the ICU. Believe it or not, the result of only one of the crimes Cummins is accused of committing Saturday night. Court documents indicate that within minutes of the alleged attack on the teens, Cummins came to this Checkers Mart at 92nd and Flavelle and pulled a knife on the clerk and a customer who were trying to stop him from stealing some items. Officers eventually apprehended Cummins, who faced a judge Tuesday, and he'll be back in court before the end of the week for what's called a preventative detention hearing. All right, for those of you not familiar with preventative detention hearings, that is when prosecutors will argue that Cummins is a danger to society, and they'll ask a judge to keep him behind bars as this case unfolds. We'll, of course, stay on top of it. For now, back to you.
For generalities, I generally say that if you want the ultimate expression of white supremacy and the white supremacist mentality, and you want to put it in the form of one person that I would name, and that's something I very seldom do, it would be Jeffrey Dahmer. He's the ultimate expression of white supremacy. Everything that he was doing, working in a chocolate factory, the whole nine yards, cannibalism and all of that, and calm, very methodical, Aryan looking.
Wasn't he with young boys, too?
Yeah, he was, I mean, I forgot how many bodies, is, you know, what, you know, something like 20 or something like that.
Mm.
Very methodical, very meticulous, went to work on time, excellent worker, working in a chocolate factory, looking at chocolate being churned all day. Then out there trying to churn chocolate at night.
Mm. Frozen femurs in the freezer. Jeffrey Dahmer.
right now on WUSA 9 News at 11. For weeks now, the community and family of a missing teacher held on to hope that she was still out there somewhere. But tonight we learn the painful truth. A man is behind bars and police say he found Maryam Silla walking in a park and murdered her. We begin here on this Friday night. I'm Leslie Foster. Just before 5 o'clock today, we learned the heartbreaking news that Silla had been found dead. And tonight, with a suspect behind bars, police and the community are asking why. WUSA 9 investigative reporter Nathan Baca is live at the Greenbelt Park where Silla was last seen alive. And Nathan, it is a sad update that none of us wanted to have to share.
It is, Leslie. This here is Schramm Hills Park. Now, on the evening of Saturday, July 29th, Silla went missing that day after a walk in her neighborhood. A devout Muslim from the Ivory Coast, friends say that she was expected to be back for evening prayer, but she never came home. Fellow teacher John Eno worked with Silla for 15 years.
We spent a lot of time planning together, and then our relationship quickly grew from just colleagues to serious friends.
Maryam Torre Silla taught at Prince George's County Dora Kennedy French Immersion School.
Very humble, and that infected you, whoever she met, with her humility and her simplicity.
Eno joined community searches through the parks of Greenbelt. They didn't know their searches were far from where Silla was found. Police say a concerned citizen spotted what they thought was a body near this area of Old Alexandria Ferry Road in Clinton August 1st. This is more than half an hour drive away from when Silla went missing. Police report finding a dismembered body near this industrial area. DNA evidence matched the body as Silla. They arrested 33-year-old Harold Landon III, but won't disclose what led them to him. Police say there's no known motive and no connection between Landon and Silla. With Silla's sister sitting nearby, prosecutors tried words of understanding.
And so that bond that we have is special. And to lose a sibling in this horrific way, it's unimaginable. So we will do everything in our power to get justice.
Whatever his motive was, it was not justified. But we're glad that he's going to be accountable.
Now, we track the criminal record of Harold Landon III. A man matching his name had a domestic violence case that was dismissed this May in Prince George's County. He is expected to have a bond hearing this coming Tuesday. Reporting live in Greenbelt, Nathan Baca, WUSA 9.
I'm sure on a night like this, people are choosing to remember the way Maryam Silla lived instead of the awful way that she died.
Mama says police misuse black people.
Now, breaking news from NBC4.
Tonight we are seeing new video of what led up to a deadly shooting where a Blendon Township police officer killed Takiyah Young.
We are also seeing for the first time what happened after the officer fired that single shot. We recognize, though, not everyone wants to see this.
This is particularly tough to watch. Some of these images are going to be disturbing, and if you do not want to see it, now's the time to step away, maybe hit mute or step away from the TV for a few minutes.
21-year-old Takiyah Young, who was pregnant with her third child, was killed. Officers initially approaching Young because she was suspected of stealing liquor from Kroger.
She was shot by an officer standing in front of her car as she tried to drive away. Again, we want to be transparent here. We're showing you today's video because it does answer some key questions many people had, including us.
Yeah, NBC4's Jamie Ostroff is here now to break down the information we are learning from this newly released video. Jamie?
Yeah, Jen and Jared, until this afternoon, the only footage we had from Blendon Township were two-minute-long clips, one from each of the body-worn cameras from the two officers that were involved, showing the moments immediately before and immediately after the shooting. Now, this new footage shows why officers approached Young in the first place and how that response was handled during her final moments. Again, this video is extremely hard to watch, so we're going to show you as little of it as possible to tell the most complete, fair, and accurate story from the beginning.
Surveillance footage from inside Kroger's liquor store shows Takiyah Young taking bottles from the shelves and placing them in her purse. Two other women walk in separately. About a minute and a half later, they approach Young while she waits in line with more liquor in a shopping basket. You see the three women leave the store together without paying. Surveillance video from outside the store shows Young walking to her car, the black sedan shown here, alone. As she gets in, a man who police describe as a Kroger manager flags down two nearby officers, helping a woman get into her locked car. One officer approaches Young from the driver's side. Seconds later, the other moves in front of the car. We know from that officer's body camera footage that he fires a single shot as soon as Young's car moves forward. It keeps rolling and crashes into the store. Blendon Township police are now showing us what happened after those officers smashed the window to get Young out of the car, telling us they needed time to blur the graphic footage.
Your foot's on the gas, Sil. Foot's on the gas.
Officers remove Young from the car and cuff her.
Shots fired, we need medics.
That is the officer who fired the shot, calling for medics about 20 seconds after Young is out of the car. He runs to get gloves and supplies while the other officer begins aid. The officer still with Young calls for a medic less than a minute later. Shortly after that, a bystander approaches wearing black scrubs.
I got it.
Trying to get her stable.
The doctor stays and helps officers. More officers and sheriff's deputies arrive, stepping in to continue the CPR that the first officers had started. As the officer who fired speaks to others on the scene, he can be heard saying,
"Just trying to run me over."
You can hear him say that phrase three times over the course of 10 minutes before he's taken back to the police station for officer support. About 9 minutes after Takaya Young was shot, the officer still on scene asks,
"Where's the medic at?"
They're on their way. They weren't told it was clear to come in.
More than 11 minutes went by between the time Young was shot and the time the ambulance arrived. As the officer speaks to others on the scene, including the chief of police,
"I'm gonna mute."
He can be seen muting his body-worn camera for minutes at a time.
So Blendon Township police say they are still looking for the two other women who walked out of the liquor store with Young. They are asking anyone who might know them to call Crime Stoppers. In the past hour, I spoke with attorney Sean Walton, who is representing Young's family. He told me he asked Blendon Township for the video you just saw, but he didn't get it until I sent it to him. Here's what he had to say about it.
It shows us nothing but more evidence of murder, and I fully believe that this just further solidifies our position that a murder occurred here and that officer should be, that officer Connor Grubb should be terminated and indicted.
Blendon Township police have not released the names of either of the two officers who confronted Young. In a statement today, they repeated their reasoning that the officers are victims of assault and protected by Marcy's Law. Jared.
Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, who's a leading candidate for president, was booed by residents in Jacksonville as he spoke about the shootings.
Florida stands with the community. Help is on the way.
Some saying his policies and rhetoric attacking diversity in the state are in part to blame for creating an atmosphere of intolerance.
Respectfully, Governor, he was not a scumbag. He was a racist.
Right now at 6 o'clock, Governor DeSantis firing back at accusations from critics who claim his rhetoric helped fuel the racist shooting attack at a Jacksonville Dollar General that left three people dead.
You don't get to come here and blame me for some madman. That is not appropriate, and I'm not going to accept it.
You're looking live at a funeral home in Brentwood as loved ones and friends come together to remember the life of one of the victims. It was an emotional response from the governor, who was here in Jacksonville to speak on COVID-19 mandates.
His event took a turn when somebody in the audience asked him about the racially motivated hate crime that happened about 2 weeks ago. Three people, A.J. Laguerre Jr., Angela Carr, Gerald Gallion, they were all killed when a white gunman went to the Newtown Dollar General store and began shooting. Kent Justice will join us in a moment with details about the memorials for the three victims. But we begin with News for Jax reporter Marilyn Parker. Marilyn, this is not the first time the governor has been openly blamed for this tragedy.
That's right. When the governor came here right after the shooting happened, he was booed by some people in the crowd, then heavily criticized by some state and local opponents who say his words contributed to this tragedy. Well, the governor was met with that same criticism today, but this time he fought back, saying he is not to blame.
Governor Ron DeSantis can't seem to escape criticism following the targeted murder of three black people in Jacksonville.
Thank you.
He came back to Jacksonville Thursday to talk about COVID-19.
Okay, thank you for your service.
The topic changed when the governor took questions and a black military veteran in the crowd was given the floor.
First of all, I did not allow anything with that. Well, listen, excuse me. I'm not going to let you accuse me of committing criminal activity. I am not going to take that. That guy was Baker acted. He should have been ruled ineligible, but they didn't involuntarily commit him.
To clarify, police records show the shooter at 15 was Baker acted involuntarily. We aren't sure what the governor is referring to when he says the shooter should have been ruled ineligible. According to the Jacksonville Sheriff's Office, the shooter got the gun legally. We've reached out to the governor's office for clarity on both statements.
You don't get to come here and blame me for some madman. That is not appropriate, and I'm not going to accept it.
The veteran is heard on another camera telling the governor,
"You have allowed people to hunt people like
that." Oh, that is nonsense. We've done more to support law enforcement in this state than anybody in throughout the United States.
And Lord, we ask that you would help us now.
About 30 minutes later, at a Jacksonville church, faith leaders demand Florida leaders to cease and desist from sowing division.
I'm not going to let you accuse me of...
We showed them what DeSantis said.
The governor didn't pull the trigger, but he's creating a culture and an environment that enables that kind of thing to happen. He is responsible.
What is your response to those who say, those who push the idea that the governor is responsible for this tragedy are turning this situation into something political?
Bigotry and biases are not political. They're learned behaviors. And DeSantis is teaching those behaviors. And it's those behaviors that commit these acts of hatred.
Now, Florida Surgeon General Joseph Latipo spoke in defense of the governor, saying in part, Governor DeSantis is a good man and that it's terrible that people take advantage of the fact that he's a different color from the poor victims of that tragedy to try to tie him into something. It's immoral, and unfortunately, it's reflective of what we've been saying for many years, but certainly through the pandemic, where people hide reality and they spin it and they try to make you buy what they're trying to sell you. And it's not true. Those faith leaders put together a letter that they plan to take to the governor's desk next week. We have a copy of that letter for you to read right now on newsforjax.com. Reporting live, Marilyn Parker, Channel 4, the local station.
Such as, obviously, there was just outright overt racism that he faced. But I'm talking about in Boston, after leading them the 6 championships of his 11. It was midway through his career. People broke into his home in suburban Boston, sprayed racial slurs on the walls of his house, and left human feces in his bed. In his bed.
Next summer marks 50 years since a federal judge ordered Boston to integrate its public schools. That decision led to thousands of black and white students being bussed out of their neighborhoods, and white Bostonians reacted with riots and violent protests. In the lead up to the anniversary of those events, a group of more than 36 community leaders today are launching a new 3-year initiative. Michael Curry is among those leaders and joins me now. He's a member of the National NAACP Board of Directors and was himself bused from Roxbury to Charlestown when he was a kid. Good morning.
Good morning. Glad to be here.
Thank you for being here. What does this initiative involve and how did it come about?
We've brought together over 40 leaders who've been in and around this issue of busing. Some of us were actually the students on those buses. Some of them were activists during that time, and some were opposed to busing, quite frankly. And now 40 or so people have come together to have a conversation around, okay, how do we look back on the past? Then to look at what the remnants are of that conversation around the pursuit of quality education, equity, justice today. I'm honored that Lou Finfer and Carolyn Crockett, who co-chair this effort, invited me to be part of it as well. So September 26, 6 p.m. at RCC, we'll launch a series of conversations, and then it'll lead into four more conversations in a series.
What do you think the predominant ways that we collectively remember what happened 50 years ago when it comes to desegregation and busing? How do we misremember what happened?
Now, I often say it takes time for truth to catch up to history. So we have a lot of history in this country. But it's just in the last few years, I would argue since George Floyd, that there's a flood of truth catching up to history. Education is one of those. Black families, brown families were challenging the notion that their kids didn't deserve a quality education. And we know Boston's history during that time, 60s to 70s, is Boston's racism was so pervasive. We were steering people away from neighborhoods. The NAACP brought the case to challenge education systems that were basically discriminating against black children. I think one is to revisit that because people like to conveniently forget why. But we had a systemic issue that was race-based in this country. We were discriminating as black people in all facets of life, not just education. And we need to unpack that so we're not blaming families, neighborhoods, kids for not having what they need to be their best selves.
What's particularly powerful about the announcement that you guys are making is that so many of you experienced this yourself. Would you mind telling us a little bit about what you remember from that time?
I was a kid who lived in Roxbury, had been raised in Lenox Street Housing Project. The big bus picks you up and you make that trip by the Museum of Science, the right turn at the light to then go over the bridge over to Charlestown. I remember police line the streets. I remember being told to duck down. I even remember my mother's fear that morning because many black mothers were sending their children into other communities with this heightened fear around violence. But I remember sitting on that bus and having people pelt the bus with rocks. And I don't remember the words because I didn't really understand the N-word when I was 6, 7 years old. But I remember it was hate. Sometimes you don't remember the words, you remember the sentiment behind it. I remember having to duck down. So I remember pulling up to the school. I remember having the guards sort of protect us with a row of police officers to walk us into school. I remember the tension as if it were yesterday.
Sometimes when you dig into history and revive debates, it can also come with trauma. Do you have a plan to address that?
Yeah, so I know Lou and Carolyn. Carolyn is Crockett is just phenomenal. Worked for the city of Boston for many years. She was a leader of my town. She is very aware of trauma as she dealt with our young people at one time. She and Lou will plan what's necessary to make sure that people can process those experiences. This is a timely conversation. I always say, if not us, then who? And if not now, then when?
Michael Curry is a member of the Boston Desegregation and Busing Initiative and sits on the NAACP Board of Directors. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
I don't want us to lose sight that things are getting better. Each successive generation seems to be making progress in changing attitudes when it comes to race. Doesn't mean we're in a post-racial society. It doesn't mean that racism is eliminated. But you know, when I talk to Malia and Sasha, and I listen to their friends and I see them interact, they're better than we are. They're better than we were on these issues. And that's true in every community that I've visited all across the country.
Developing tonight, a 14-year-old boy has been indicted for attempted murder and civil rights violations. He is accused of pulling and holding a Chatham teenager underwater at a local pond while calling him racial slurs. Boston 25 News anchor Carrie Cavanaugh has the troubling allegations laid out in court records.
A short ride down a small dirt road in Chatham will lead you here, Goose Pond, a quiet place beloved by locals.
The water's so beautiful. I come here just to be quiet and peaceful.
But according to police and court records obtained by Boston 25 News, that quiet peace was disrupted by an alleged act of racially motivated violence on July 19th. Records show a group of teens arranged on social media to meet up at Goose Pond that day. The alleged victim, a teen boy who is black, told Chatham police he soon felt targeted. In a handwritten statement, the victim told police the suspect, identified in records as 14-year-old Jack Sheeran, began, quote, threatening me, calling me racial slurs. Jack continued to throw stones and threatened to beat me up. Then he said things got physical. Jack Sheeran held on to my life jacket and pulled me underwater and back up about 4 to 5 times. While doing it, water got into my mouth and nose, and I could not breathe. The teen said he was shouting over and over again that he couldn't breathe, and that's when the suspect and another teen started laughing and called me George Floyd. The victim said Sheeran and another kid came toward him again trying to pull him back underwater. That's when he called out for help. He says other kids started coming in the water, telling the suspect to stop. The victim got to shore, packed up his stuff, and left. Visitors to Chatham hearing these allegations were shocked and saddened.
The age of, you know, the kids are young and teenagers with such an act of violence.
The Chatham Select Board released a statement in town saying in part, the town and our police department have a strong relationship with the Monomoy Regional School District, and we will be working together proactively to deter events such as this from taking place in the future. The district attorney's office says a grand jury indicted Sheeran on several charges, including attempted murder and a civil rights violation. The defense attorney has requested a psychological evaluation of the 14-year-old client who's being held after a dangerousness hearing.
And that defense attorney, Kevin Reddington, did not respond yet to my request for comment today. Due to the nature of the charges in this case, Sheeran is charged as a youthful offender. That means although the case is in juvenile court, it will be open to the public. And he's due back in court September 13th. Carrie Cavanaugh, Boston 25 News.
Those details are tough to hear, Carrie. Thank you.
Things are getting better.
This is very true. And we can use Florida as an example because they got a very intense situation going on there where literally white people are evacuating and those that are staying are being called stupid. And they're trying to figure out why on earth would you stay here? Who cares about the price of your house? Y'all are skin cancer prone and more susceptible to the balance of the sun's rays.
Before we wrap up the program, I did want to ask, did you have like a specific link or a news story about the evacuations in Florida? I know some of the listeners, they would appreciate being able to check that out.
Man, if you just Google, I don't got it exactly on me right now, but I'm sure if you were to Google skin cancer, Florida, Caucasian evacuation, if you put some of those keywords in, you'll find it.
Okay, so Mr. Noak, the terms of the plea agreement are as what the prosecutor just stated, that you are going to be entering a plea of guilty to the 2 counts of aggravated child abuse and 1 count of contributing to the delinquency of a minor. You will be adjudicated guilty, which is a criminal conviction on your record. Do you also understand, sir, that by entering into this plea that it may subject you to involuntary civil commitment proceedings set forth in Florida statutes 394.910 through 394.931. Do you understand everything that I've said thus far?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, I want to also advise you, sir, that you are going to be sentenced to 7 years in state prison to be followed by 10 years of reporting probation. In addition to any of these special conditions of probation, you will also participate in and successfully complete a mentally disordered sex offender treatment program, that you are also not eligible. Okay, you may, according to the state, you may be eligible for early termination if all of the conditions of your probation have been completed, that you have had no violations.
And to clarify, the terms stated in five is there is no prohibition on early termination. However, there is a requirement that any modification to this agreement be agreed by the state and the court.
Okay. All right, sir. Now, with respect to this plea agreement, I have on each page next to defendant's initials MN. Did you, in fact, affix those initials to each page?
I did.
And have you reviewed each and every component of this plea agreement going through page one and page four?
I have.
Now, it says page four, having read the above-mentioned terms of this plea agreement and having been advised by my counsel, David Tarras, I, Michael Noak, freely and voluntarily enter into this plea agreement and agree to abide by all terms and conditions of this plea agreement and agree that failure to comply with any terms or conditions within this agreement constitutes a violation of probation and subjects me to be sentenced to the statutory maximum penalties provided by law for the crimes for which I am now pleading guilty. And then it has a signature over the name Michael Noak. Is that in fact your signature, sir?
Yes, sir.
All right. And I am now going to place my signature on this plea agreement in that I am now going to be ratifying this plea agreement as negotiated between the state of Florida and your attorney.
B-Cows, Gusty Renegade, in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Saturday, September 9, 2023, so I have been told. This is our weekly compensatory call-in. Dial in if you have thoughts, observations, counter-racist suggestions to share. The number 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Few things to get to before we get started. Number one, make sure I get this in for last week. I played a report again this week about Takiya Young and pregnant black mother, New England area. Ohio region. Where racially restricted region, I might add. I played a report about this book from last weekend, and I think I told listeners I felt like I wanted to apologize because I generally do not watch the footage of enforcement officers when they shoot a black person, kill a black person, choke them out, whatever it is. I generally don't watch all the body cam image or whatever other image footage that they have of these incidents. I'll read about them just so that I can talk in an intelligent manner, but I generally am not trying to break down the footage and see every angle and all of that. I just, you know, don't think that is constructive and good for black mental health. I saw this footage pretty close to when they released everything, and this started being talked about and dissected about a week or so ago. I think a listener emailed it to me. And, you know, hey, got to talk about this, make sure that we are informed. I say pay attention, local, national, global system of white supremacy, racism. Certainly, if you're thinking about producing offspring or if you have children yourself, this would be something to talk about. Why this racism thing is such a big deal and why do you talk about this all the time and talk about it as though this is, you know, a really lethal issue in the lives of non-white people. This is why. So there would definitely be great reasons, important reasons, I'll say it that way, to investigate this case, to share, make sure people are informed. But, man, I did not want to see the footage of Ms. Young being killed. We have listeners who live close to this part of Ohio, have for years. Some of them emailed me. And they were talking about the case, and they went right to what Mr. Fuller has talked about for many, many years, probably at this point, decades. They went old school Fuller. The one word, comply. I think he switched it up a few times, got the alliteration with the F, no fighting, no fussing, no fleeing, and whatever. Either way, we have still not won large numbers of people classified as black in this part of the world. Large numbers of us have still not learned. I really couldn't even make an assessment of the situation with Ms. Young in that manner last week because it was just 21 and she's pregnant? Wow. That is heinous. But I mean, that is the system of white supremacy, racism, the worthlessness of black life. Child died in this one as well with Miss Young up in Ohio. Now, I didn't know all the details from last week. This is all still evolving. This, you know, just happened right towards the end of August. And I think the body camera footage has only been available for about a week. This week, because I think they had said initially the reason that the enforcement officers were flagged down in the first place was because there was a suspicion of shoplifting. So they released the body camera footage last week and let everybody see that, terrorize all the black people, especially expecting black parents, especially black moms. I would think, man, that could have been me. Then they come back this, like Wednesday, I think, Tuesday, Wednesday, because they had a protest in that part of Ohio. Then they released the store CCTV footage of Miss Young allegedly looting the liquor bottles. And then they, you know, go out of the store and all the rest of it. Now, again, I really couldn't even, I mean, that's the sort of thing I would normally be on. Sobriety would be best. Don't I say that all the time? Sobriety would be best. John Roan out there in Kansas City, he was at the liquor store and got killed by a race soldier, stabbed to death, called a nigga, and then stabbed to death. And they lollygagged about making an arrest at the case. He was at Liquorland. That's where it was. That's the name. That's the specific name of the spirits location. He was at Liquorland. I would normally be all on that, but I could. Pregnant 21. You heard the officer, suspected race soldier. She ran me with the car. She ran me with it. He's already getting prepared. Oh, I know she's pregnant. She ran me with the car. Did you have to kill her? I didn't want to kill her, but she ran me with the car. Dr. Welding has a whole chapter on this. Justifiable homicide. I told the listener when they emailed me, I said, I already knew how this is going to end. Justifiable homicide. I don't need to keep it. Yeah. Justifiable homicide. Why was she in the liquor store anyway? Maybe they'll do a settlement. She ran me. That's what he's going to keep saying. She ran me with a car. Yes, what they said about Miriam Carey, and I said her name when I emailed some of the folks in the Buckeye State, like Sue Klebold. I said Miriam I. Carey, her one-year-old daughter, not that far removed from the womb, was in the rear of the vehicle, and I'm sure those officers in D.C. could see, whoa, really young child, not just a Negro child, a really young child in the car, whoa. I don't think this is a bomb threat. This is not old Timothy McVeigh, Reb and Vodka. I don't think with a young child in a car seat, no less, not riding shotgun with a grenade. Maybe we should hold up to the minute they didn't do that. Life not worthy of life. And then accused her of, oh, she ran the barrier. Yeah. But the whole situation with Miss Young, totally disgusting. Sobriety would be best. Comply, as Mr. Fuller has said for many, many years, if not decades. Absolutely. I think no stealing is in the 10 stops, unless I've been misinformed. Don't let me lie on Fuller, but isn't that in the 10 stops, no stealing? So, I mean, it's a whole lot of, you know, behaviors, small behaviors that would stop all of this. I would think, you know, it's almost 2025. They got robot dogs and cameras everywhere. That sort of low-level theft, you're probably not going to be able to pull too many times. They don't really care. You're pregnant. We'll let you slide. You could be shoplifting baby formula. They will lock you up and have an attitude about it. Why didn't you get out and get a job in here stealing baby formula? Why don't you be ashamed of you? That's what I say about it. much less you stealing malt liquor or whatever. Like, come on. Allegedly. But I mean, ugh. This is the same place where they shot John Crawford III in Walmart with a toy gun, where he was lied on. White man called enforcement officials and said, oh my God, he's terrorizing us, he's holding us hostage, and they didn't even prosecute him, nor did they prosecute the officers who shot him immediately. So if you are alleged to be looting liquor, I mean, he ran me with a car. Yeah. Dr. Francis Cresswellsing, ISIS papers, justifiable homicide, unfortunately. Comply. My apologies again to listeners. They had lots of trigger warnings in the video, so you could have muted and all of that, but man, I did not want to hear that. Now, speaking of reports I did not want to hear, people tagged me on social media this week when the news came about the plea deal and incarceration of Brother Polight, Michael Noak, in the Sunshine State down there with Governor DeSantis this week. I'm going directly to the Miami-Dade, shout out the retired firefighter, his part of the world, the Miami-Dade government website, Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation for Miami-Dade County. Brother Polight, a.k.a. Michael Noak, N-O-A-K. Prison number 23015133. Booking date September 6, 2023, 2:40 p.m. Eastern Daylight Saving Time. Case information. Child abuse, aggravated, great bodily harm, engaged in sexual act with a child, sexual battery, violence between the age against someone where the victim is between the ages of 12 and 17, contributing to the delinquency, dependency of a child. You heard the plea agreement from earlier this week with Judge William Altfield, A-L-T-F-I-E-L-D, 7-year sentence, 10 years probation. I'm very aware. We've done reports when they have victims of white supremacy many times get these really horrendous plea arrangements where they terrorize you. Remember John Burge? They terrorize you and say, you did it. And I have seen no evidence that that's what happened here. Brother Polight, Michael Noak, has talked about this case. I didn't hear him say anything about he was pressured and they railroaded me and they tried to do something and they coerced, some sort of confession out of me. They forced me to take this plea deal. I had really bad attorneys. I didn't hear any of that. In fact, I heard what I would term my view, bragging about the amount of money that he spent on his legal defense. He wasn't saying that he had inept attorneys representing him, inept counsel, where they brokered a really bad deal, didn't inform him properly, or fell asleep during the – I didn't hear any of it. Didn't even get to court for them to fall asleep, but he didn't say any of that. He was talking about how much money he paid for his great representation. And the judge, William Altfield, asked him, did you understand? Did your attorneys explain things to you in a competent manner? And he said, absolutely. So I haven't heard or seen any evidence that this is one of those cases where, particularly where they get young non-white people, Central Park 5 type of a thing, and mess them over and make them agree to something and terrorize them, make them agree to something that they didn't do. I haven't seen any evidence of that. In fact, I even heard speculation there was acceptance of this plea deal because of the charges that I just read. Taking this plea deal avoids going to court to be registered as a sex offender. We talked about that before. Whoa. Just having a criminal conviction is a big deal, but when you have to register for a sex offender, wow. Talk about, what's the cliche they used to say, cramping your style? Jesus. And, hey, molesting children, some people should be registered as sex offenders. All of that to say, Gus P. being tagged. I heard Brother Polight back in the day, and then this happens. Oh, my goodness. I heard Brother Polight back on Gus's program, back on the cows. Another thing I was not interested in seeing, happy about seeing for this week. This is the second time for someone who has not been a guest on this program in over a decade. Second time in the last 12 months, I'm referencing Brother Polight. That's why I was able to find that sound clip so quickly. The sound clip that we heard before we heard the court proceedings and the plea agreement, the sound clip was from Brother Polight's last time ever visiting the cows as a guest. Him talking about white people leaving Florida. And I asked, you have any evidence, link, news reports, something? He said, oh, I don't have it right now, but if you look online, you'll find it. I looked. I didn't find it. And we have lots of Florida listeners like, woo. You, if we ever replace white supremacy with justice, Florida should be in the running for where is the cow's after party. I have not ever heard from one cow's listener, and I've been to Florida since that program. I did not see any evidence of white people leaving Florida. I said all this when I played that, and in fact, when I played that sound clip within the last 12 months, I was playing it right after the hurricanes hit in October of 2022, and even under apocalyptic tropical storm, white people did not evacuate Florida. They didn't even leave Jacksonville a couple days ago. They just went to shoot up the Dollar General. I brought all of that up within the last 12 months, man, I said, I hate talking to non-white people. Did a whole program talking about that. We have a white guest-only policy. That is part of the reason. Neely Fuller Jr. said, in fact, I can take this two ways. Neely Fuller Jr., going in chronological order, seventh time he visited the cows, 2010, he said, make it clear. What are you doing? Are you here to replace white supremacy with justice? Are you here to clown around? Are you here to rape children? Why are you here? He said, it's been a lot of time wasting where we come and we are talking, pretending we are about replacing white supremacy with justice. That's not what we are doing. He explained it in detail that almost the exact same subject matter, said they were in New Orleans decades ago trying to get black medical students, still don't have black doctors and black medical professionals, especially black males. That's what we're here for, try to figure out how we can correct that, get them funded. They're trying to get champagne and see if we can go and chase the young ladies. Same thing we heard with Brother Polight. I don't know if they were chasing underage young ladies in New Orleans, but same type of thing. Make it clear. What are you doing? We talked about, that's point two, going in chronological order, last summer. This was not too far along after the shooting in Buffalo at the Tops and many other subsequent acts of white terrorism. Rob in Southern California, by way of Wisconsin, said we are crying out for a solution, metaphor. And I said, that's not true. I said, the vast majority of non-white people, we are not focused on replacing white supremacy with justice. We are not looking for a solution to this problem. That's self-evident. Look around. Look at our behavior. Case in, I mean, sad case in point. I even had to think back, like, how did Brother Polight even end up on this program? Because, I mean, even the name, Brother Polight, anybody who has heard Dusty Renegade for any length of time, when I gag and am ready to throw up when one of you all calls in and I have muted people, Brother Dust, I just want to say, that's why. I'm not on all that nonsense. Brother this and brother that, making it seem like we're closer than we are, being on some old nonsense, as opposed to let's be serious and just get this problem solved. No, we're about a lot of goofiness. Like I said, I'm even, how did brother, because I am not interested in brother, I am not interested in all of that. I'm not interested in a teaspoon of that. Replace white supremacy with justice. And the people who generally are interested in all of that generally have no interest in Gusty Renegade, which is fine. Our paths never cross. But it made me part, like, how did he end up here at all to even get that sound clip talking about white people evacuating Florida? Other victims of racism. Brother Gus, we're doing an event. Can you promote and get Brother Polight on? And man, I would not do any of that. We would have got white guest only rule in effect much earlier, and we would not have wasted time, not 5 seconds from brother. But matter of fact, I'm bringing him up any time. We get a brother, like Brother Polight, really? And it's been lots of that down through the years, just makes it more difficult for victims of racism who are sincerely trying to solve the problem. I'm not trying to chase your daughter around. I'm not trying to chase you around. I'm not trying to chase your mother around. I'm trying to replace white supremacy with justice. Absolutely disgusting. At any rate, once again, we are not those other platforms. I'm not on all the red, black, and green, not implying everybody who's on that is insincere, not trying to solve this problem, but man, I am not on that. This is not the brother, sister, red, black, and green, and pan-African. We place white supremacy with justice immediately. And at the end of the day, I'm really about studying white people, not showing off, bragging for other black people, studying white people. They are the experts. I cannot stress enough, do not waste black people's time. Things are so serious. We have so many sincere problems. My Wi-Fi is not even working correctly today. Sound is off because of that. We do not have time to waste that. I mean, I added that to the 10 stops. That was my ad. Do not waste other non-white people, victims of racism's time. This is exactly what I'm talking about. If you want to go out here, run around, and do your sexual intercourse, and that's what's most important to you, do that. Don't be out here on no charade like you are about justice or even anything close to solving the racism problem. Oh, disgusting. I'm giving the inmate number again from Miami-Dade County, and I'm not celebrating. Like I said, one, I'm disgusted. How did he end up here in the first place? Replace white supremacy with justice, and this sort of thing is encouraged in an environment where white people do not care about children. This is encouraged in an environment where JonBenet Ramsey at six is a sex symbol. Ooh, and all the rest. This has been encouraged for a long time. Back to the plantation. Talk about that with Thomas Jefferson and all the rest of it with it. Don't talk about that with J. Strom Thurmond. This is an enormous component of white supremacy racism, sexually abusing children. All of us should be, that's at least, should be one thing. Maybe we can't unify around no name calling, but we can at least unify around with not sexually molesting, abusing children. That is done. Be careful who you allow around your offspring, if you're dating and all of that so-called. No exceptions. That includes Gusty Renegade. Be careful who you allow around your offspring. Classified as white, not white, male, female, age is irrelevant. Be careful who you allow around your offspring. And really, we heard some of this, or we talked about this when we read Bill Russell's book. You produce offspring and there's a divorce or what have you. You already have talked about that because that's very likely to happen, right? We talked about all that dating and nonsense stuff should be greatly muted if not done. The number one priority is the offspring. All that, that's how you got here in the first place, is all the dating and such. All that, you got to go out and I got needs. No. The need is to be an attempted parent in the system of white supremacy, not bringing every Tom, Dick, and what's your name? Brother around your offspring. Male or female. I'm so disgusted. Inmate number again, 230-151-336 for Michael Noak, N-O-A-K, Brother Polight. What's polite about molesting children? That last visit with in between talking about white people evacuating Florida, Brother Polight also talked about what we really have is black supremacy misappropriated. That there were many points during that broadcast that you can go back and listen. Never again. Never again. Don't waste black people's time in the system of white supremacy racism. Anywho, the number 605-313-5164, decode 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Number again, 605-313-5164, decode 564-943 pound plus *61 if you would like to participate. The timing for that piece to be included was even, I didn't really know where to put it. It was almost separate because the news segments should have concluded with the drowning in Chapman. 14-year-old white child, I'm going to hold you under the water at the end of the summer and call you George Floyd as we snicker. But no, we got to address Brother Polight. Wasting time and energy for degenerate behavior. Anyway, my list here. All right, we'll be here tomorrow, new school year. Folks who have young black children, especially if they're in the public school system, we'll be talking about that and racism, white supremacy tomorrow, Sunday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. We just spoke about this with admitted racist Dr. Kirsten Hextrom, admitted racist white woman this past Tuesday. She was on the broadcast, talked about education as well. I think she gave a lot of constructive information. A number of listeners said that one of the listeners thought she was so constructive, they wanted to read her book. Doesn't get any better than that. Reading is more important than watching television. Incidentally, a number of non-white people victims of racism have sassed Gusty over the years. They say if a white person says, I am a racist, it is incorrect to call them an admitted racist. What would be the accurate label for a white person who says, I am white and I am a racist? What would be more accurate than admitted racist? Question mark. Let me know, please. Thank you. We'll be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. If you did not hear Dr. Hextrom this past Tuesday, check that out as well. Let's see. The reports I will share really quick. Just in Boston, I'm so glad that we read Bill Russell's autobiography, Second Wind. He gave so much information. He even worked with regards to so-called integration in Boston. They have many, many news reports where he was involved in that. He wrote about that on a regular basis. He was such a prolific writer. He wrote several books, and then he wrote a lot of newspaper articles in the city of Boston while he was there winning all those championships and everything. And he worked with local NAACP chapters. And just Bill Russell, William Felton Russell, extraordinary attempted counter-racist. I'm not aware of him molesting any children, but they should include a number of his articles, and his work should be a big part of the effort in that time period. Also, Ted Landsmark, now, I don't know, for Boston people, it might be, oh, God, he's seen everything. In my view, that's got to be the front picture for whatever project or exhibit that they come up with to talk about so-called school integration in Boston. Ted Landsmark, black male, he was literally speared with the American flag by a race soldier who did not want little nigger children like Bill Russell's offspring in school with white children in Boston. And the infamous photographs, I think it was the Time photo of the year for like 1975 or one of those years really close to then. But that should be like, they should blow it up, make it huge, like 90 feet tall or something, and put it outside. But that, and then they have a news clip. It was on the now defunct Melissa Harris Perry program way back when it was on MSNBC. And they talked about all of this in Boston, and they played some of the archival footage, and it was a gang of racists, males and females, outside, just like Little Rock 9. And it was a white woman, and she said, forget, I think I got the archive recorded, but she said, forget it. You know, if they're going to let the black children in or whatever, I'm done with it. Just let the niggers have it. Make it, let the niggers have it. I was like, that is another one. Make sure you get that in. And then they crapped in Bill Russell's bed, and we did a pretty good job, right? They can add Tom Brady, get him in there towards the end or whatever, but that basically would cover it. And it's more segregated now than it was 50 years ago. The end. Tom Brady. Anywho, let's see. The segment with the governor in Florida. Oh, wait a minute. Let me get the mayor in Alabama where I get my political office. So when they were talking with the segment in Alabama, they have, I guess, a white mayor, and then they have the black mayor as well. And they said that the old white city council and the former white mayor, they had a secret meeting with a secret ballot, and you had to be eligible to run on the ballot in order to get it. Like, woo, can we get this in court, please, to just get all of that officially, like, transcribed and on record? What, because they tell us all the time, isn't it supposed to be democracy, right? Isn't that what they say? All of this secrecy and nepotism, because they said they didn't even have elections. They said they would just hand it. That's one of the favorite words here. I mean, you want to talk about nepotism? I guess probably some cronyism too there. I'm sure everybody's not like directly related, but like we don't even have elections for public office. Dad runs until, you know, he's tired or what have you. And I just pass it over to my son and, you know, give it over to my nephew or cousin or what have you, or friend from kindergarten. I don't know. Whoever. For one of my children's friends from kindergarten. I've known him. He hung out at the house a lot, so I pass it on to him. And it just goes like, what? What? They said that the black male who's trying to run and do all of this, they said that he secretly filed the paperwork, or quietly. That was it, but he quietly, almost implying that he did something sly about all this. The people who are doing something sly and nefarious and sneaking around, white people in Alabama, as usual, land of the Scottsboro boys and Rosa Parks, no less, now, and the Birmingham bus boycott. At any rate, they said that the white people are not talking at all. Press come around and, oh, can you see? Get out of here and join, make this black and break. They said the black people are afraid. Why would they be? As a matter of fact, this is why you study local national history. Now, why would the black people be afraid in Alabama? It's almost 2025. Well, Rosa Parks does have a deep connection to Alabama. Rosa Parks did not spend her last years in the state of Alabama. Why is that? The same type of terrorism that those black people right now, you had better not be talking about no race. That same sort of terrorism is exact, and I mean exact. Ain't been no progress. Zero. That's the exact sort of terrorism that Rosa Parks and her entire family faced, which resulted in them all absconding to Michigan. Progress. White people have a code. We're not talking, just like the Harris family in Columbine, right? The black people, and that's exactly what we heard with Bill Russell. He was in Louisiana right next door where they lynched a black male, and you better not talk about it or else. That was in the 1930s. We're talking 90 years ago, and it's the exact same thing. You still like this job? Be ashamed if your house were to catch on fire or something untoward were to happen to your children. Might be best if you just keep quiet. That is also racist code, the art of intimidating and hushing niggas. White people are apparently very, very good at hushing niggas. Anyway, they said in the report in Alabama that it's not a race thing. It's not a race thing. That was what some of the white people said. It's very correct. It's not a race thing. It is a white supremacy racism thing. Because I'm sure if it was a white person said, I want to be met, this would not be happening. And certainly they wouldn't have all these secret ballots and all the rest of it. Come on. They locked the doors of City Hall for 2 years. This was a white candidate, white City Hall members. None of this would be happening. They spoke with some of the victims, and they said it's not necessarily about race. Race does play a small factor in this. That is the result of white supremacy racism. Again, it's correct. It's not necessarily race. It's racism. You can't even say the word. You got to say discrimination and bias and prejudice and Jim Crow and all this other old nonsense. It's not necessarily racism. You didn't even say race. Race, not race. Race does play a small part in this. Like, are we playing a sport? Is this a game? And then it plays a small part in this. All that minimizing that is so standard that we are conditioned. We're not supposed to talk about this at all. And then if you do, I'm just going to talk about it a little bit. I'm not going to say that it's all racism. I'm not even going to say racism. I'm just going to say that race is just a tiny, itty-bitty, teeny-weeny, tiny teaspoon of the problem. And even that, they go, You don't get that, Negro. Almost 2025, they tell us about progress, right? Anyway, I forgot, Detroit Red. Malcolm X, he should be in the Boston exhibit, right? We read his autobiography. He spent all that time up there, right? That was before he even got down to New York and changed everything around. Shouldn't he be in the exhibit? I guess that's a little bit before they got the school integration, but man, Detroit Red, he should get an honorable mention for the history of Negro Boston and trying to go to school. Anywho, number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Let's see. We'll see if I can work it, get our first few folks who dialed in with a hand up. Hopefully people will not be lollygagging and spectators since I'm Wi-Fi less with my laptop. Wi-Fi without this is a system-wide problem about 10 minutes before we went live. So that would be crammed. Folks, do not spectate. Wait till the end. Hand up. That makes it easier. Much obliged. Let's see. Folks who dialed in with a hand up. Line should be open.
I'll be heard.
Okay.
Let's see. No, go ahead, ma'am.
Okay. Well, I just thank you for allowing me to speak. I'm sorry for the confusion just now. The news segments that were played when they were talking about the Native American boarding schools. The lady doing the interview, she asked, what sounded like a white man, but I'm not really sure. She says, what would you like to see happen now? And he said he would like to see a comprehensive investigation to call in boarding school survivors and get their testimony. I think it's good to have info, but I'm not really sure what that's going to do. White people know what they did because they're the ones that did it. So that was a little confusing to me, but I think it is helpful for people to understand that those boarding schools existed. When they were talking about racism in the San Antonio school district, one of the school officials came out and made a statement like, racist harassment is not permitted and should be reported to school administrators immediately. I hear news segments regularly about black children reporting racist behavior, racist mistreatment from white children, and the mistreatment doesn't end and it does not result in punishment for these white people who practice racism. Another part where they were talking about the U.S. seeing a surge in efforts to restrict or ban books, and this white lady, she asked the question, how do you think these claims make everyday average white people feel? I think everyday average white people practice racism, so they probably don't want non-white people to think and or speak logically about racism. And I'm not even convinced that was happening at that school, but yeah. And the teacher, her name was Kelly Kidwell. She said she was disappointed that one parent could have so much power over the classroom. And I think that's kind of a it's not the most accurate to say. Like, yeah, she was a parent, but she wasn't just a parent. That was a white woman. And that's an important distinction, because if that was a black lady who had a child going to that school, she would not have had the power or the ability to decide what was going to happen in that school the same way as that white woman. The part where the scientists have created an exact replica of a 14-day-old embryo without using a sperm or an egg. And they said this embryo looks pretty much the same. Can it grow into a human? And then he said, no, that's illegal. Like, what? Can it grow into a person or not? We didn't ask you if it was illegal. And I think that once white people, you know, put this stuff out there on the news, and, you know, just to give you an idea that, you know, people are thinking about this, they've already done it. So, I mean, that's just my thought. You know, I don't have any evidence of that, but, man, they had that dollar to sheep, like, I don't know, that was probably 20, 30 years ago. So it's no telling what these people have been doing in all of that time. I took a lot of notes on that New Bern, Alabama part, and Gus, you talked about it a lot. So I'll try not to say the same things that you did, but, you know, some of the things that I noticed about that segment is they said it was a dozen churches, but not a single grocery store. And I did notice that the black male who was elected mayor, he told that white woman, what you're doing is unjust. I appreciated that. You usually don't get non-white black people speaking, you know, honestly and accurately to white people that are mistreating them. So that sentence, I really appreciated it. They denied that there was any sort of racist conspiracy to keep a black man out of the job. But, you know, he appointed his city council. 85% of the residents of that town were black, and a white man gave him the keys to the city hall. Then they changed the locks. And, I mean, city hall has been locked for 2 years. They're still paying taxes, paying the lawn crews. Everything is still running, which means white people are still running the city. And you know what? Even if they would have gave him the keys to City Hall and he would have went in there every day, white people still would have been running the city. But, you know, it just shows that white people are in control of everything. If they had a special election, white people are, I don't want to say clowning, but I don't know. They are about the business of practicing racism in that area of the world and in all other ones that I know about. Leonard Mack, the black male who was convicted of raping a white woman, you know, after all of these years, they, you know, overturned the conviction. And they said his picture was the only black man in the photo array. You know, I don't think he's a black man, number one. But you send this person to jail and you have a photo array with all white people and one black male, then you send this black male to jail for I don't know how long. And he said, now I can finally say that I'm free. Man, you know, VGQ, he has suffered enormous mistreatment. I would really like to know what he means when he says he's free. Like, what does free mean? And, you know, another thing, you know, I looked on the internet to try to, you know, figure out some more about this person. You know, white women, a white woman was responsible for sending him to the penitentiary for all that time. And then there was a picture of him in court with a white woman on the left side and a white woman on the right side of him. One lady had her arm on his shoulder and he was crying in the courtroom. So even after all of that, it seems like these white women get to take responsibility for getting his conviction overturned. You know, so they're the people who are ultimately responsible for, you know, causing the problem, and then they make it look like, well, we solved the problem for you. I feel like I'm talking a long time. Zakiya Young, the black lady who was shot, she was pregnant. I have not watched that video, but it just seems like, I might have misunderstood it, but it seems like the officer shot that lady, then pulled her out of the car and then handcuffed her. Is that what happened? I mean, if that happened, oh, wow, that is, I don't know, monumentally incorrect. And after the whole thing, you know, the news reporter just tried to get people to call in and report the other two black females that were on the video, you know, allegedly stealing alcohol instead of saying something about the incorrectness of that lady being shot by a race soldier. That's, you know, that really bothered me. And that's all I have for now. Thank you for allowing me to speak.
Much obliged, Lauren. They did indeed handcuff Miss Young after she had been shot and the vehicle crashed. They, I guess, did whatever to get her, extract her from the vehicle, and then they handcuffed her. I guess as either she was expiring or if she had already died at that point. But, yeah, I mean, that is, niggas are dangerous. Never can tell. He had already said she ran me with the car. Well, I'll tell you, she ran with the car. Can't trust niggers once they ran with the car. The male caller who yielded the photo, it was Leonard Mack. She said, Leonard Mack, you might see the photo of Mr. Mack after he spent 50 years. That's probably longer than most, if not all of us on this call have been on the planet. Well, maybe not all. Most, though. Leonard Mack. Hugging the white female judge. Now, they normally, you can't even shake hands with the judge, but Leonard Mack, the white female judge, she hopped the bench. I got to grab this black male, strong black male, 50 years in prison couldn't, but come here, Leonard Mack, give me a hug. I don't know if that, is that the prize? After all that, man, I don't know if I want, like, I'm real cautious around white women. I'm going to stay over here, y'all. I'm going to take a fist bump, and I'm going to be gentle. Now, Baylor, I'm just going to do the fist bump. If that's how you're going to watch me, I'm going to just do a real gentle. Barely, but that's enough. I'm going to back up, and right, I don't do the white women. Thank you. Male caller who yielded the floor. Much obliged, sir.
Greetings. Can I be heard? Got me hurt.
Yes, sir. That might be Rob by way of SoCal or SoCal by way of Wisconsin.
Can I be hurt? I'm not Rob from Wisconsin.
Oh, my fault. Sorry, sounded similar. Yes, sir. We can't hear you.
Okay. Yeah, greetings, Mr. Gus. Greetings to all the callers and the listeners. Leonard Mack, I thought the same thing too. He didn't do 50 years. He only did 7 years. That's why I was like, that's why I thought about this case. What Miss Lauren was saying about the white women, that was the first thing I noticed about him. Like, white women aren't responsible for labor. Man, it's crazy. Like, they was real touchy feely with him. He was on CNN doing an interview where the white woman was like, it was just weird, man, her posture was just real weird. I just, like I said, white women were responsible for him getting out of jail. I wanted to, the students at Edward Waters, they deserve to have a monument. They need to have a ceremony for them for saving them students. I don't think nobody's really been talking about that. I wonder, are they talking about that on their campus? Because, man, they're heroes. The Morgan State, they seem like they had a pretty thorough security plan from this police chief. I thought that was kind of interesting. But what I was also getting to with Edward Waters, Morgan State, and the Kennesaw State, like HBCU students, man, they're being harassed on a daily basis. And I felt like that was kind of what helped the Edward Waters students, I guess, because they are cognizant of, well, they are conscious of what's going on. They know to basically look out for these white people. So it seems like it's something that they do talk about on a daily basis. In 2020, Edwards Waters, they got funding from the state of Florida, from Governor DeSantis, and that enabled them to go from a college to becoming a university. I just thought that was interesting that we eventually got to see Governor DeSantis go there and speak or whatever. And I felt like when DeSantis, while he was at that school, he sounded like Ronald Reagan when he was when he went to the Bronx to talk to the people in the Bronx about their issues. He was yelling at them and screaming at them. I thought that was kind of similar. He wasn't yelling or screaming, but he was talking down on them. You guys, Ms. Lauren, you, Mr. Gus, y'all pretty much said everything about Newborn, Alabama. I thought that was pretty interesting also. I thought it was a VGQ to the people there. Like you said, I felt like they were trying to say that it wasn't about race, and it almost kind of sounded like they were blaming themselves for not being able to they got a mayor now. He still can't be mayor, so I don't know why they were blaming themselves. I thought that was sad. The jail cell, I want to say, was, I don't know if it was Fulton County Jail. They were saying that one inmate died every week. I thought that's pretty sad. Also with the book stamped, like you said, it only takes one white parent to say something. I thought it was interesting too how the kids speaking just like their parents, pretty much. He stabbed two people and then he got away, and then the other guy, Harold Landon, how both of them they both had committed crimes and they got away with them, and Harold Landon was the guy who killed the school teacher. He was arrested. They won't even tell you but he was already in jail. So I don't know how they found out how he committed that crime, but he got arrested for another crime, not the crime that he committed. Just like the guy who stabbed the two people, he went out and committed another crime after he had stabbed the two people. I thought that was just interesting how they can commit a crime and go commit another crime, and then get out and go commit another crime. I also feel like I just want to send my condolences to Takaya Young and her family. I feel like if they find out those two girls, they're going to probably charge them with murder, or they're going to charge them with something. So I'm kind of worried about them. The busing situation in Boston, I thought that was kind of interesting. Just when we talk about our histories, every time we talk about our history, man, it's just like, it's just all events of trauma. And he ended up saying trauma in that clip, so I kind of thought that was kind of, I had already wrote that down, and when he said it, I'm like, man, we always celebrating trauma, all our Dr. King Day, all our events are trauma. And I had a I wanted to say too about, he was talking about the Klebos going to OSU. I think Jeffrey Dahmer went to OSU too. I had a question too. The guy said, if not us, then who? And if not now, then when? Is that a metaphor, Mr. Gus?
If not us, then who? I don't think that's a metaphor. That's a legit question. If not us, whomever is doing the talking and whoever is in the group that's listening, that's pretty direct. And then if not us, then who? If not, what's the other part? If not now, then when?
Yeah, if not now, then when? It was just a question. Yeah, if not now, then when?
I don't know. Oh, okay, here we go. I think I had the volume down. Been a tough day for me. So what's the second part again, sir?
If not us, then who? If not now, then when?
Mm. I will think on it some more. At this point, I would say I don't think that is a metaphor. But, yeah, at this point, I would say no. I don't think that either part of it. I don't think that is a metaphor because it's just talking about, you know, which people, if whom exactly, they might be unspecified folks or at what point in time. But at least at this point, I don't think that is a metaphor. Asking questions. But I'm open if other folks think it is, you can let us know. Much obliged, dear sir. Sorry. I guess I had said Rob in SoCal before, so that was in my brain computer. Been a rough Saturday. Well, because all of them are. Other folks who dialed in, if you have a hand up, commentary to share, line should be open. Proceed.
Greetings, everyone.
Retired firefighter in Florida? Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. This is the first thing. I recognize the mugshot of quote-unquote brother, I forgot the name. I thought I recognized his face, but I didn't know I didn't bother to read the article. I had heard he was having some problems even months or a year or so even before that. But anyway, the report that I'm about to give is a follow-up on something that happened a couple of weeks ago. Yesterday, they buried the flight medic who was killed in Broward County, was buried yesterday. What is news to that incident, the BSO sheriff has both control over both the law enforcement and fire and rescue. And that person I've mentioned several times on this program, Mr. Gregory Tony. The helicopter that crashed, he had actually went to the mayor and the commissioners asking for a new helicopter in the first place. Months before that crash actually happened. What I would identify the irony of it all is that it was tragic for a considerable amount of non-white people, not just Mr. Terrison Jackson, but a victim that stayed in the apartment that where the helicopter crashed was killed, Miss Loreen Wheaton. If it wasn't for her, and this is what the paper described him as, her boyfriend that got up before this helicopter crash, got up and went to the bathroom, he probably would have been a victim of some sort also. The call that the fire rescue helicopter was going to was involving a hit and run situation. And even with the victims, they were non-white people. The mayor who Mr. Tony was asking for this new helicopter happens to have been a white male, Mr. Lamar Fisher, which the name doesn't sound like a white person, but it is a white person by the name of Mr. Lamar Fisher. I was just kind of fascinated over the amount of tragedy that was suffered by a lot of non-white people who were classified as black that did not even know one another. But I would assume that, you know, with the advent of housing, not too many people who have some kind of control and power and money are not going to be staying in an area where you're close to an airport, where, you know, planes are flying back and forth, that sort of thing. So that was probably one of the reasons why a lot of the people that was in this situation had these tragedies happen to them. And that's my weekly report. Thank you for listening.
Much obliged, a retired firefighter in Florida, Lorene Whitten, victims in the crash. That's the exact sort of thing that Lauren has told us about before with regards to lack of safety in workplace situations where you go and make reports about safety and they don't really take them that seriously and kind of, and even the way he explained it, that you got all of these people who are classified as black end up suffering and passing away. Lorene Wheaton and her spoke, even the people that did not pass away, who could have passed away and all the rest of it, they're going and asking a white person, hey, we got a potential problem. This could be a safety issue. Talk about that all the time. That is generally the power dynamic. It is like in North Carolina. It's not one black parent who gets upset. Man, I want to read this. I want to talk about the hate you gave, all this nonsense. I want to read. That is generally not the way it goes. It is generally one white parent is enough to change the whole curriculum. One white person with all the power that you got to go in bed. Can we please? And if he says no, hope the helicopter doesn't hit your house. Other folks, if you have commentary to share, number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Folks, we missed totally. Proceed.
Can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am. These mom.
Greetings. I think it was about the school in San Antonio, or it might have been in a different city, but they were talking about how they weren't keeping up with like the school's infrastructure. I was thinking about when I was teaching at school. One thing that I really thought about was where I was teaching, it would get really, really hot, like at least 105 in the summers, and it was expected to be that hot. And like the way that the schools were set up, there was asphalt, so there's nowhere they didn't prioritize having shade or trees. So then basically during the whole summer months, starting from like June to like around late September, there would just be no recess. And all of the children would be inside, and they never had gyms, which is such a simple solution to just make an indoor gym. Because I'm pretty sure the places where it rains a lot, they have indoor gyms. And then today I was driving around, and I was in a city that's predominantly white, but it gets very hot there. And I noticed that all of the streets are lined with trees for shade for people who are walking. And the infrastructure is just kind of set up to like cool the people down while they're outside. And then I kept driving forward, and when you go to like the non-white area, it's just barren. Like, there's no trees, and it's even hotter here. The sun is just, like, blaring on everyone. I just thought that was really interesting because I've been reading a lot of articles about just, like, heat stroke, people getting heat stroke just going on walks. And I feel like even though it's September, it's still very, very hot. Sometimes, some places, it's getting even hotter now. And a lot of the times, the places where it's really hot are, like, where the majority non-white people are. So it just makes me think about how, again, like everything is kind of set up for non-white people to suffer, die, don't care about them. Another thing that I was reading an article, and it was about fentanyl, and it was about how there's like going to be a looming crisis of fentanyl use in Nigeria and other parts of like Western Africa, which I thought was interesting because I know that just had someone on the broadcast talking about like basically how drugs are used against non-white people. I guess there's already kind of an epidemic of people in Nigeria using I think it's called tramadol, and it's like 40 times less potent as fentanyl. And they said that in Nigeria, there's one doctor for every like 8,600 people, and that they don't have the infrastructure to even support if someone has an overdose coming in. I mean, it was not a priority in America that has a lot of technology, and they weren't able to really prevent all these deaths. So it's very scary to think about in the future. And then the story about the embryo, I thought Lauren made a good point how they didn't answer the question. But also just makes you think, like, it seems very likely that, you know, the system does not really have to be here. If these people can create an embryo, like, it just really makes you think, like, why do we exist under white supremacy? It has to be because white people want us to exist under it, because they could obviously, you know, have a system of justice if they found it useful to them, but they don't. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Very important point. These moms, Mr. Fuller is one of the few people that I hear to take that position and to say it publicly that individuals classified as white, they could solve this problem. They could produce justice. They have the resources, the means. They like it this way. It doesn't have to be this way, but they like it this way. He said he came to that conclusion some time ago, and I just that's why I say that's one of the most important questions to ask. Are white people going to voluntarily stop practicing racism? Asked a lot of guests that, white guests that. If they are dedicated to white supremacy racism, that would be a different way of thinking about how we go about solving this problem. And that, in my opinion, better explain why is it still this way? Why has it been going on this way for so long all over the world and all the rest of it? This is what they want. They like it this way. Now, with Nigeria specifically, that, at least for me, asterisk right there. India as well, all of the UNESCO reports, they had about a decade ago, they had reports about the population explosion on the continent of Africa in total, India as well, but in particular, Africa and then specifically Nigeria. They suggest Nigeria, they are projected to have 1 billion people by 2100, less than 80 years. Then when they reported this a decade ago, it was not jubilee time. And whoopee! Oh, God, what are we going to do? Oh, how much Ebola can we get? So, yeah, that would be a reason. Sobriety would be best. Dr. Welsing added that to the 10 stops. That would be a reason to promote that. This all could have been a test run, the fentanyl, and then we do the real day. I mean, they don't have Narcan everywhere here. it might take a long time to get Narcan to Nigeria. Sobriety would be best. We have done whole programs. If I had Wi-Fi, I could give you the name, and or if I was not a victim and my memory was better. But October 2020, tail end of the Rona, we had a white man on the program. They literally have done research and maps where it is a perfect overlay. The areas that were so-called redlined, where they warehoused black people in particular, are the exact areas, what he said, no trees. All of that is very deliberate. We played a few of the reports over the years that they talk about in different areas. Now they have some tacky programs to plant trees in non-white areas, but they talked about the expense of upkeep because when you have all those trees, that means you have to have the people that go around with those trucks to trim the branches and all of that, and if there's a storm and clear the debris and all of that. And, of course, the areas where Negroes live are deprived. So sometimes they don't have people to do that sort of maintenance, so they get all kinds of excuses. But the end result, in fact, they even have really nice maps, and I think we linked to some in the program that I'm referencing that show it is about sometimes, I mean, it's significant. Sometimes we're talking a 10-degree Fahrenheit difference between the areas where mostly white people live and where black people live and the impact that that has on health. We even played some of the reports more recently. They were talking about the extreme weather events here on the West Coast and how they were Oregon. They were especially hammering black people. They do not have the money to have the AC on, blasting at 60 degrees all day and all night. They don't have money for an electric bill like that. And then you don't have any trees. You don't have any shade. All you have, well, she asked, I even remind me, Bay Area Ma, she said what they do, they don't say that we go outside for recess. They say, you what? What did you do, Jamal? You have been banished to the asphalt. Get outside. She said, this. I said, well, wait a minute. Aren't they having the heat? Wait, like, whoa, wait a minute. What do you mean? I got to go outside. You're trying to kill me. Wait a minute. I had a whole separate group. I didn't even play it, but it was talking about just the impact of extreme weather events on recess, exactly what she said, because it's so hot, we can't go outside, and the problem that that is causing, man, that you don't even need an imagination. You got the children, like, where's the Ozempic? You need to get rid of these pounds. Sitting around eating Chips Ahoy, and then we had the pandemic, so you had all that Zoom learning, and you can't go anywhere, everything shut down, so lots of people sitting around for all that time period, eating bad food, gaining weight, playing on the phone, and all the rest of it, watching YouTube videos of other people eating bad food, and all the anxiety and everything else. Man, we can't even go outside for recess because it's too hot. Man. Children are coming back later this month. Maybe we'll see if any of them have been impacted by the, or even if they have air conditioning in the school and how much. Had the reports earlier, we didn't have a guess, but we played the report where they talked about the impact of taking a test in an environment that's 80 degrees, in an environment that's 69 degrees, and how that impacts your performance and how well your brain functions when it's high heat. Lots of different ways that black, particularly black children, suffer with all of this, they call extreme weather, especially in those old schools. That's where I went to school, one of those older schools. A lot of black children with no air conditioning. Some days it's so hot, they would do the same thing. It's so hot, everybody go home. It's too hot in the building. Someone might die. Just go home early. Other folks, commentary that we have to share. Don't wait till the last minute. Yes. Did we miss any folks? Other folks have commentary that they wanted to share? I don't know if we got everybody. I'll double check the I'll double check the, let's see, the number again, 605-313-5164, decode 564-943-pound, press star 61. If you would like to participate, number again, 605-313-5164, decode 564-943-pound, press star 61. Any other folks have comments that they need to share, we'll give by 2 minutes, unless we got everybody. We'll be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, talking about education, racism, white supremacy. We'll also be here on Wednesday. Look, if that's it, should have a full month for September. Some of these programs I wished that we had been able to do in August, but, hey, time is right and exact. In fact, we did just have that program talking about how white people use drugs as weapons against us, John Patasha's book. Some of the folks referenced in that book who talk about racism and what it means to be white will be visiting us this month, starting Wednesday, normal time. So we'll be here tomorrow and then Wednesday, and then we will wrap up Sue Klebold's book on Thursday, our study of Columbine, normal time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Chime in as we wrap up, weeks, months, really, of study of Littleton. Other folks, anything they need to get in before we get ready to wrap up?
Yes, Gus, I was just thinking of one subject. With the advent of non-white people, non-white black people not complying to the orders of law enforcement, I've learned a lot with the DCS program, learning about the thought processes of black children, black males, because we do go constantly over and over to help create a code in these young people's minds about what to do. And in this case, what to do when encountering law enforcement. And it is a considerable amount who the first thing they would say when you ask the question, without even sharing with them any logical suggestions, the first thing they would say is, "I'm going to take off running." And I thought about it, you know, when I was their age, it wasn't that much of information through authorities such as school system about what to do when approached by police. And especially nowadays, but there's almost nothing that is absent from children not having the access to. And it goes along with what you were talking about, why you don't watch these clippings of black people being mistreated. Well, children have access to it, and I'm pretty sure they are looking at these things constantly. So there is actually a challenge when you're talking to them about what to do when you come in contact with law enforcement. So it's vitally essential, because for the most part, I would say, and I would just use the term, a considerable amount of them need assistance for someone to give them suggestions based on logic on that subject. It is paramount, especially black males, because they're going to be approached even more. But there is a growing amount of black females who are having the same problems and issues on what to do. And in most cases, they actually fail in what to say, what not to say, or just be quiet, period. In a lot of cases, they don't have any rules at all. And when you ask them for what suggestions they would have, it is It's scary. It's scary as far as what they're saying, that I would run from them, you know, or I would say this, which is, you know, cursing or something like that. All kinds of stuff, you know, and that's just what's on my mind. Thank you for listening.
Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. That is what's modeled, unfortunately. It's really, you know, Neely Fuller Jr. has been comply for decades, but that is not modeled. That is not typed out for halftime of the Super Bowl to make sure that all of the young niggers have got this and have been drilled on this. I think a number of either attempted parents and or people who just work with non-white children who have done exactly what retired firefighter said, that, you know, should be foundational, really just asking the questions, really going back to the same thing we talk about all the time, just asking questions. What would you do? And hearing what they say. And I think a number of folks have said it is appalling what they have heard from some of these folks in terms of the responses. Like, it does not sound like, oh, yeah, these are folks who are going to survive and are going to live long, healthy lives, even if they have, you know, what they call a brush with the law. They know what to say. They know. No, it looks like, man, you better get a hug in now. Like, run. Jesus. You saw Mr. Bradley, right? You how fast do you run? You know, they got the German Shepherd? Yes? Okay. Well, I'll look for the YouTube video for the track week. Let's see your speed. Let's see your 40-yard dash time. Can you hop that fence? Because some of those German Shepherds, they got hops. And they like dark meat. So you like to run. Hey, somebody is going to get a raise. Like, oh, my goodness, we love it when the niggers run. Woo, get him. Check him. I would just tell them, go back and see Mr. I wouldn't even tell them that they're running. Oh, okay. Mr. Bradley, he's right here down the road from us. So, yeah, that could be you. But, yes, talk to your children and just see what their thinking is. And then even ask Walter, how far are you going to run? Where are you going to run to? How fat do you train on this bike? Woo, man, that's okay, that's the plan, right on. Stunning. Other folks that we've missed totally, do you have commentary to share?
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Hi, Gus. It's the guy that sent you the email, the caller from Ohio. I used to have a 216 number.
Yes, sir. Ms. Young.
I was just calling because in the email you had asked some questions, so I forgot to just give you a call back and just let you know who it was that you're talking to. That's my primary email, so that was about it. I just was about to say something you said about the heat maps that they have for cities, a project I was working on, still working on it. I work heavily with mapping and pulling the data from government agencies. And it's pretty interesting what you see when you start looking at, like, the actual data that they collect on environments. I was able to talk to a guy who was I'm trying to remember how they say it. Like, they pretty much are, like, city engineers, but their focus is in, like, heat management. So one of the areas they are showing is, like, the differences in how they manage heat in the Chicago area and the construction of the city. So the way they build cities is very specific to the environment they're in. And the guy was showing, like, this is why the buildings are structured this way. They put in, like, elevated parks with grass on them because it creates a cooling effect, I guess like a ground cooling effect. But it's in very specific areas. And from what I've seen, it's predominantly in the wealthier, whiter areas. They're also showing, like, even the designs down there in Miami about how they manage the heat and the human aspect of moving around Miami. It was an interesting conversation. I think another guy did a documentary on it. He's an actual engineer, and he has a YouTube channel just dedicated to going to different cities and showing, like, what the thought process was behind actually building it out. In terms of the what was that other part? The Nigerian side with the drug epidemic. I had seen a report about 3 years ago, and they were talking about how alcoholism was starting to become a big thing in the whole of West Africa, and that a lot of European and American brewery companies are looking to move into West Africa, and they're starting to sell beer like crazy. So I think you'll also see an alcoholic epidemic spring forth, because they're talking about the increase in the numbers of actual distilleries there, meaning the people, they can produce it there instead of just importing it. And that's one of the things they're highlighting, is the fact that they were actually building the facilities there. So you can't get adequate health care as a black person, but they will give you plenty of liquor to get you intoxicated. But wanted to give you a call. I like the email. The questions you asked were very good questions, because you never know, it could be a ficing email. Well thought out. I'm going to check the email. I haven't been able to get to the computer yet. I usually get to check my emails about end of the week. So like the one I sent you, I think I sent Sunday. I just got around to checking them today because I'm just swamped with stuff I got to get done. But the projects that I'm working on are starting to kind of tear off. And so I remember what I said back then, and I'm a person who, if I say I'm going to do it, I do it. And so I forgot to shoot you the email, and I'll see what you responded to. That's it.
Much obliged, good sir. Appreciate it. Yes, untiljustice@gmail.com if folks have follow-up information, such questions. With the heat, like if I had Wi-Fi, it's been a tough day on the plantation. They all are. But if I had Wi-Fi, I would tell folks the name of the white man who visited with us and talked about those details explicitly, and all of the intricate details that go into planting, and the number of trees, and even the types of trees that white people get, as opposed to, and shrubbery and other means to make sure that it's cool, as opposed to places where non-white people are. Lots and lots of asphalt. Massive difference, and I mean that difference in heat has an enormous impact on health, even your quality of sleep. I don't know if people have been in environments where it's really, really hot, but that can make it a lot more difficult for you to sleep. Even that has an impact on your overall health, quality of life. And white people know this very well. Folks, we missed totally anything to get in before we wrap up.
May I be heard?
Caller in Florida? Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Greetings to Gus, the host, the listeners, and caller. I heard the segment where the governor, I guess he was getting defensive and emotional, I think somebody said in the audio, about how he was calling the white shooter a madman or something like that, and said that he was baked or acted. I just found that to be like another act of racism, deflection, and racists don't like to be challenged or questioned, confronted by black people, you know, just being direct and really wanting answers. And then I think it was a part of it where I think that was a black male that said he used the term scumbag, I think. Like, no, a racist, not a scumbag. So I like that part. The segment where I think it was about the mayor was that possibly in North Carolina, where it was one victim, I believe, said that it is about race. And then I heard that they said that people were being afraid, or I guess it was black people being afraid. And I'm like, you know, that's because of the impact of the system of white supremacy. And it has been that way and continues to be that way. In the segment where the racist, I think that's who stabbed someone, I think, two black males. And the person used the term bias crime. And I'm like, they can't even say hate crime now? It's like, is that going to be a new term they're going to start utilizing or, you know, if it ain't a euphemism, they don't want to be direct and just say racism. That's going to be too effective, I guess, on the victims and people who want to speak out against the system. And other than that, that's all I have to share. Thanks for allowing me to speak.
Much obliged, caller in Florida. My man Ron DeSantis did get rather emotional. I had these niggers come out here and mess up my shine. I'm trying to get my White House run on. You all come out here and mess up my campaign. I have niggers yelling out every time. Come on. Be appropriate. It's not my fault. You don't blame me for some. He called him a scumbag first. And they didn't like that. So this time he's going to say madman. Yes. They Baker acted him. Yes. Shouldn't have even been eligible to get the gun. I like how the journalist did come and say, we have not found where that's accurate. Seems like he did legally purchase the gun. So hopefully the governor will explain that one. But yes, got very upset. I don't care if you are a veteran. You don't come in here and get inappropriate and mess up my White House shine, man. Shut up and sit down. No more questions from Nick. That's what I would do. No more questions from niggers. We are vetting everybody. No more questions from niggers in the state of Florida. That's not my campaign. The good our 3 hours. We'll be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. One, much obliged. Leonard Mack did not serve 50 years. He was convicted 50 years ago. That was where I got the 50 from. But he did not serve 50 years. Strive for accuracy. He was sentenced, I think it was 7 to 15 years. Struggling with no Wi-Fi. But even then, strive for accuracy. And I did confirm, even with no Wi-Fi, yes, it was Leonard Mack, the judge, hopped down to give him a hug, which, you know, that's, come on. Fist bump, man. I, too, with Lauren, did appreciate, just like the victim in Florida, he's not a scumbag, racist, the gunman in Jacksonville. In Alabama, the mayor should be mayor, black male victim. He said, you all are being unjust. It is somewhat uncommon for me to hear that. That if you are afraid, if the white people are terrorized, you better not say it's about racism. Okay. It is about justice. You sound like Dr. King. It's about justice. And I want them to practice justice. I want everybody to practice justice. Right now, they are being unjust. And you can just do that all day long. You know it is about racism. That's why we don't have justice. But sometimes white people don't let you say that. No problem. Justice. Stop being unjust. Stop being unjust. Stop being unjust. See, you might get killed if you say, stop being racist. Or put you in jail, but stop being unjust. Stop being unjust. Other people might even say, are you being unjust? Well, they keep saying you're being who's being unjust here? Justice. Justice. Replace whites. That's what we have been about. That's how I started all this. That's what we haven't been about. We have been about everything else but replace white supremacy with justice. We will be here tomorrow, hopefully contributing to that effort. So, but man, given what we heard, sobriety would be best. Model that for the universe. Race soldiers do the same thing. See if you can get all the niggers here on all the drugs. That was in that book. Rising population of dark people classified as black on all those opioids, fentanyl, and all the rest of it. Model that. Dr. Welsing, add that to the 10 stops. Sobriety would be best. No using and selling drugs. Model that to the entire universe. That right there messes up race soldiers' plan. They want a whole lot of narcotics. Narcotics for all. The niggers. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time to replace white supremacy with justice immediately. No name calling, no throwaway offspring, no gossiping. Man, I totally forgot. Maybe that's a good thing. I totally forgot, or it could be brain damage, but I did totally forget. Tomorrow is the opening weekend of brain damage in the NFL. We are competing live. I love it. You will have something better to do than watch black males get brain damage. We will talk about education. What is more important? Context of White Supremacy signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
Even my conditioning has been conditioned.